They try to lock me in the darkness and throw away the key. But there's something deep inside me that the blind can't see. But I don't care what they think, they can define me. The only thing that matters is I've been set free. Yeah, I've been set free. You can put me in a cage, but I'm a bus right out. No, there's nothing gonna hold me. Hit me with the rage, yeah, I can go 10 rounds. No, there's nothing gonna knock me down. No, you don't get to tell me what I can be. Go and fuck all you want, but I know what I believe. You can put me in a cage, but I'm a bus right out. No, there's nothing gonna hold me. Hit me with the rage, yeah, I can go 10 rounds. No, there's nothing gonna knock me down.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it is the time at hand, the moment you've all been waiting for. I'll be bringing up my friend here, Robert Gurr, in just a little bit. He is a Latter-day Saint. He is a Mormon. He has been on my channel in the past, and we are going to be having another discussion. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be a very, very respectful, challenging discussion. I'm anticipating him to bring out some interesting information on where he's coming from as a Latter-day Saint. For those of you who are new here, my name is Clay Powers. Every Friday night, we have what's called Friday Night Apologetics, where I will have different people come on my channel who might have a friendly debate, pastors, apologists, different people at times, and have fun, different discussions. So lately, I've been having, actually last Sunday, I had a really nice, really respectful conversation with a Latter-day Saint. His name is Kevin, who came on my channel. And then last Tuesday, I had a guy that was a surprise, came on my channel named Steven, who is an ex-LDS guy, and he was sharing his perspective. So it's kind of, I think, the week of LDS. There we go. Wasn't really planned like this, but this is the way it turned out. So I'm pretty excited about that. So I'm going to bring up Mr. Robert, and let's get us both up here. Robert, how are you?
I'm good. Hi, Kelly.
Great. Great to have you back on, Mr. Robert.
Yeah, all right. Thanks for having me back.
Yeah, it's great. It's great. How is the weather out where you're at and out in Seattle?
Probably the same as it is up in British Columbia.
Yeah, so. We're pretty much similar. Yeah, it's hasn't been too bad lately. It's been off and on, but the weather's starting to get nicer again. All right. Well, let's just briefly go over our format for any of you out there who are here watching and listening. If anybody who are friends of Robert, welcome here. Glad you're here. For those of you who would like to look in the video description for the YouTube, there are links over there from our past discussion with me and Robert. There's a link also to his YouTube channel, so if you guys want to go check it out. I also want to make sure that was in there as well. All right, so tonight our format is pretty simple. It's a casual debate discussion, just having a good time discussing information. We're both going to have an opening of 15 minutes each. We'll then have a time of 10-minute cross-examination, and then it'll be followed up by another cross-examination of 5 minutes each. That will get us kicking it off. Then from there, we're going to have a free-for-all where we're just going to be going back and forth and pulling out our hair But it will be an hour about of just an open discussion between me and Robert. We've agreed upon this, and we're just going to have a conversation, as if you will, if we were just hanging out somewhere in the park or we were in each other's house and we were just sitting on the couch having some good old fashioned iced tea. And well, maybe not for Robert. He'll have ice water, but
lemonade.
There you go. Have some of that lemonade. Good. Yes. Hot dog on the stick lemonade. And then after about an hour or so, what we're going to do is offer up for any of you guys out there. Hold your questions. If you have a question directly for me or Robert, hold it to the end. where we get to the question and answer time, because we won't be answering any of those right now. Now, for those of you who are in the room and you want to have discussion with each other, that's fine. I've got a couple admins in here. I can see them kind of keeping things in order. So hopefully you guys are paying attention to any comments out there. Please be respectful, any of you out there who are here, whatever side you are on. And then after our time of question and answers, we'll do it for about 15 or so minutes, seeing how it goes. Hopefully we have a lot of you asking questions. Then we'll wrap it up with each of us speaking for another 5 minutes. So that's kind of the basic format that both me and Robert have agreed to. Any additional thoughts from you, Robert?
No, we're good.
Good. Thank you. Okay. All right. Well, then we're going to be getting it going. Glad to see all of you out there. Angie, Daniel, Jeff, some names in here I don't familiar with. So great to see you guys out there. All right. So I'm going to get my clock ready. And what I'll do is I'll put just me on the screen when I'm talking. And then when you're talking, I'll put you on the screen. That way we're going back and forth. And then when we have the open discussion, then we'll have both of us on the screen back and forth. Okay.
Sounds good.
All right. So I'm going to get my clock going here and we'll just put him on mute and I'm going to get my clock started. All right. Ready? Here we go. All right, everybody. Welcome to the Berean Perspective. My name is Kelly Powers and we're going to be having a debate today on the Trinity and LDS Godhead. There are three things that I would like to address in this opening discussion about the differences that we have. First will be the God of Christianity. Second will be the God of Mormonism. And third, examining what the scriptures teach. You see, the Bible teaches from Old to New Testament that there is one God. The Bible teaches that the Father is called God. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Jesus Christ is called God. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. The Holy Spirit is called God in numerous places. Acts chapter 5, verse 3 and 4. 1 Corinthians 12, 11 and 18. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 15 through 17. Lots of scriptures. Jesus Christ is called God in John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being by him. Everything that's come into being, was with him, and not one thing came into existence without him. It goes on to teach in verses 14 through 18 that Jesus Christ, he was the one sent from the Father. He came and took on our likeness, our flesh. He came to reveal the Father to mankind. He came to reveal who the Father was. In fact, in John chapter 14, he teaches that if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Now, Jesus Christ is not literally the Father, but he came to represent the Father to mankind. Colossians 2:9 says that Jesus Christ was deity in bodily form. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, it says that Christ was the exact representation of God come in the flesh. Hupostasis corrector. He is the very essence, the very nature of God to come. One of the interesting things about this debate is that God is by nature eternal. The Bible teaches in Psalm 90, verse 2, Psalm 93, verse 2, from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. In Isaiah 40, verse 28, it talks about God being the eternal creator, the eternal creator. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 35 through 39, talks about God being the very one who made all things, who is the eternal one. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 10 states, I am the Lord. You are witnesses, declares the Lord. I am he. I am the first. Before me, there was no God formed, and neither shall there be after me. That word formed in the Hebrew is the Hebrew word yatsar, which means to be made, to be brought into existence, to be created, to be fashioned or formed. God says there was no God before him, and there's no God after him. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 8 states, is there any God besides me? I know not one. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 8. Yet the Bible teaches in Deuteronomy 6, 4, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. How does that work? Well, when Moses wrote the book of Deuteronomy, through, I believe, the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he didn't use the numerical Hebrew word for one. He didn't use the Hebrew word yakid, which means numerically one or solely. He used the Hebrew word called ikad, which has the meaning of a compound unity. For example, Genesis 1:5 says morning and night were one day. Genesis 2:24, the man and the woman become one flesh. In the book of Ezekiel 37:17, it says that the two nations, the two sticks, will become one under their shepherd. There are many examples in the Old Testament how words are used. So then how can God be triune and one at the same time? Our brains cannot fully grasp all the things that are stated about God. But this debate is not for us to figure it out. This debate is to examine, what does the scriptures teach? What does the Bible teach? Does the Bible teach that there is one eternal God from everlasting to everlasting? Thou art God. Does the Bible teach that there's a Father, there's a Son, and Holy Spirit, and these three are identified as being God? And the answer is clearly, unequivocally, yes. So then the next question is this. What's this debate about? What's the differences between the God of Christianity, if you will, the triune God, the Trinity, the triunity, compared to the LDS Godhead? You see, LDS believe that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are distinct. They use the word separate from each other. Myself, as a born-again Christian, I believe that Jesus, the Father, and the Spirit are distinct from one another. But I do not believe they are three separate gods. I don't believe that God the Father was once a man who became a God, just like the Father he had before him, the Father he had before him. In fact, this is what really separates Christianity from Mormonism. See, in fact, Joseph Smith, the testimony of Joseph Smith is crucial, paramount to a Latter-day Saint, if you're a Latter-day Saint or Mormon. Because Joseph Smith, according to 1820 in his history, what's called his Joseph Smith testimony, he goes out in the woods and is praying to know which is the true church to join, which is the true sect to go to. He had a religious background. His family had religious upbringing. He wanted to know. And I think that's a sincere thing. I don't know whether what really took place is really genuine or not, but whatever took place, it was not of God. Because his testimony claims that God the Father and Jesus Christ appeared to him. And he was told to join none of them, that they were all wrong, that they all have an abomination, their creeds are an abomination, their professors teach the commandments of men. So Joseph Smith's testimony from the very start is, don't join any church. All their creeds, all their teachings are an abomination, commandments of men, they're all wrong. Well, what happened? Later on, he claims to be a modern-day prophet. Now, what's called the King Follett funeral discourse, where there's a few different things that are going on here. And if you're familiar with it, it's called The History of the Church, Volume 6. It can be easily accessed online. It's also referenced in many other sources that are considered official Mormon sources by the church. There's references in here as well from official publications from the Latter-day Saint Church. What did Joseph Smith claim? What did Joseph Smith present himself as? Joseph Smith, it stands on him or falls on him. That's the Mormon church, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, either stands on Joseph Smith's testimony, what he called it to be true, or it falls. Okay? Joseph Smith said, I will prove the whole world wrong. I will prove you are all false teachers. He challenged the clergy. He challenged the professors. He challenged all these different people to prove him wrong. And in fact, he goes on to say, I am going to prove to you that I'm a true servant of God. I'm going to prove to you that I'm a true servant of God. He says, I'm going to take away the veil. You have imagined and supposed that God was God from all eternity. I'm going to take away that veil so that you may see. I want to get to a few references here. Actually, I'm not going to be able to do that for time. Let's go by memory here. I can't pay attention to what I have on the screen. Joseph Smith claimed that God was not from everlasting to everlasting. In fact, he states that God was once a man, as we are. God is once a man as we are. This is in the History of the Church, Volume 6. And he goes on to teach that God was once a man who became a God. And just like his father had a father, and his father had a father. And he goes on to teach that this is the first principle of the gospel. Page 305, he says this is the first principle of the gospel to know for certainty the character and being of God. This is an important point. This either proves that Joseph Smith is a true prophet of God or a false prophet. Now, I'm sure my opponent here respectfully would be saying amen, because he believes he's going to be able to prove these kind of things and that will give support to Joseph Smith. I don't believe that's going to be the case at all when properly examined. Joseph Smith goes on to say, in fact, actually in a way mocking Christians, saying, how can Christians believe that there's three in one? It's like a monster God. He's a gigantic monster God. In pages 474 through 476 of History of the Church. He goes on to say that I've always, for the last 15 years, have taught the plurality of gods. Joseph Smith unequivocally is openly saying, I have openly taught the plurality of gods. He goes on to say that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are three separate gods. Now, friends out there, if you are a Christian, you know without any hesitation, the Bible does not teach this. The Bible does not teach this. The Bible is very clear, as I've already given references, just some, that the God of the Bible is from everlasting to everlasting. He was never at any point not God. To become God means at some point you were not God. If he was once a man who first became a God, that means he wasn't God in the beginning. Jesus Christ was actually eternal. Before he came and took on flesh, he was in the eternal. He is the very creator of all things. John 1, 3, Colossians 1, 16 and 17, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2. Jesus Christ was God by nature who came and took on flesh. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Jesus Christ wasn't first a man who became a God. He didn't have a pre-existence according to LDS doctrines and teachings. You see, one of the things that's also peculiar about LDS teachings on the Godhead is that Jesus Christ is actually the first spirit child of a heavenly father and a heavenly mother. And in fact, we are all apparently spirit children of a pre-existence. That includes Satan as well. But that is not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that Jesus Christ is eternal. He was God before he took on flesh. He's the very creator of all things. And in fact, he created all the angels, which Satan is a fallen angel. I want to share a few things here quickly as time is running out. Doctrines and Covenants. Doctrines and Covenants, section 20, verse 17, or reference 17. By these things we know that there is a God in heaven who is infinite and eternal, from everlasting to everlasting, the same unchangeable God, the framer of heaven and earth, and all things which are in them. This is important. According to Doctrine and Covenants, God has always been God, from everlasting to everlasting. There was not a time where God was not God. That is contrary to what Joseph Smith taught. Section 20:28, which the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost are one God, infinite and eternal without end. This is what Christians believe. The Christians believe that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one God. There are references in the Doctrine and Covenants that affirm the doctrine of the Trinity or the triunity of God, or that God is eternal. There is nothing in Doctrine and Covenants ever teaches that God was once a man who became a God. In fact, if you were to read the Book of Mormon, let me just give you a couple references here. In Moroni, actually, let's go to Mormon first. Mormon 9:9. For do we not read that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and in him there's no variance of shadow of changing? And Moroni 8:18. For I know that there is not, that God is not a partial God, neither a changeable being, but he is unchangeable from all eternity to all eternity. Again, these references contradict what Joseph Smith taught, that we've imagined, supposed that God was God from all eternity. He says, I will refute that idea. This is his claim. This is his challenge. Doctrine and Covenants and Book of Mormon say contrary. Let me give you one more reference from 3 Nephi 31. I believe it's 3 Nephi 31, 21. That is not the right reference. What is that? I'll have to wrap up here. I got a few seconds left. Might go a couple of seconds over. What I've shared with you is that the Bible teaches that there is one God. There are three distinct persons who are called God. For Christians, we call this the Trinity. Even LDS sources that I don't believe are inspired would agree with what I've shared and actually contradict what Joseph Smith taught. One last reference. Joseph Smith said that the first principle of the gospel was to know the character and being of who God is and what he was teaching. Galatians chapter 1 says, if we or an angel come from heaven and preach to you a different gospel other than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. Paul felt so important about that. He says, if we or an angel from heaven come to you and preach a different gospel, let him be accursed. The teaching that Joseph Smith taught, that the first principle of the gospel was to know the character and being that God was once a man who became a God, is clearly and unequivocally a different gospel of the Bible. All right, Robert, I went a minute over, so if you want 16 minutes, you can have 16 minutes.
Okay. I don't think I'll take 16 minutes, but hang on.
There you go. I got you.
Just finishing up one last thought.
Yeah. Tell me when you're ready.
For my rebuttal. There we go. Okay.
You ready?
I am ready. So, first of all, I want to clarify that these views are my own views. I do not represent the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, but I have studied a lot, and these are what I have found during my studies. So Kelly asked me to bring out the big guns, so that we can all learn here. So here we go. I brought them. In 1820, a 14-year-old boy went into a grove of trees to pray. His prayer changed history. Joseph Smith saw God and heard the things that the prophets of old had seen, prophets like Isaiah, Daniel, and John the Beloved. Joseph Smith saw God, and for the first time in 1800 years, he was understood again. One of the things that God told young Joseph was that the creeds of Christendom were an abomination to him. And I'm going to defend that statement and demonstrate why they are an abomination. Trinitarians have been hiding behind bad translations, false interpretations, and wrong definitions for two millennia. Few were brave enough to openly call out the problems with the Trinity for fear of punishment. It's not unlike Darwinism today. If you try to cast doubt on evolution, you're ostracized and blacklisted. But it was worse for the Trinity. While denying evolution only gets you fired from your job, denying the Trinity could get you killed. And it wasn't just the Catholic Church and the Inquisition. Protestants tortured and killed other Protestants over theology. One example was Michael Servetus. He was a well-educated reformer and a leading medical doctor, but he taught against the Trinity. And this is, I know you're not Calvinist, but this is some evidence against Calvinist, because he ended up in Geneva, and John Calvin is the one that had him burned at the stake for heresy. So John Calvin is a murderer. And the idea that it's okay to punish people over the Trinity comes from the Athanasian Creed. This is the first creed that God called an abomination. It damns people to hell for not believing in the Trinity. Well, the problem with the Athanasian Creed is it wasn't written by Athanasius. It was a forgery written by some hack author over 100 years later, after Athanasius had died. and it was never canonized by any council or synod. Yet, Protestants use it today to condemn others who don't believe in the Trinity. Even if you don't use or believe in the Athanasian Creed, there is still the tradition that you must believe in the Trinity in a certain way to be saved, or believe in Jesus in a certain way to be saved. So ask yourself, if you believe people need to believe in Jesus to be saved in a certain way, and then realize where that comes from, a forgery. Christians fired the first shots against Mormon theology over 1,500 years ago, because it doesn't say anywhere in the Bible that you have to believe in the Trinity to go to heaven. It doesn't say you have to believe in Jesus in a certain way to go to heaven, especially when the Trinity is not taught in the Bible at all. The Bible doesn't use the word Trinity, nor does it have the word Trinity in it. Even worse, the Bible doesn't even define the Trinity. The Bible doesn't say they are three separate persons. When you look at what the Trinity is, the definition is three persons in one God. The Bible doesn't say they are separate persons. So I'm going to ask Kelly, where do you find that verse? The Bible describes them as three separate divine beings and gods, not three separate persons. So I'm looking for the very specific verse that says they are a person or persons and not beings. Because in every dictionary I use, persons are by definition beings. The Google dictionary I pull up defines a person, and the very first definition says a human being regarded as an individual. So is God three human beings regarded as individual, like the dictionary says? It's important that we understand and use the same language when we use English. You can't use the English word person in a way that isn't demonstrated by English. Persons are beings, and if they are separate beings, then they are also separate gods, as Joseph Smith taught. So where does this idea come from that they are separate persons and not separate beings? Certainly not the Bible. Can't find it in there. It came through the apostasy, and specifically the Council of Nicaea. Eusebius of Caesarea was the bishop there at Nicaea, and he wrote what happened. He was actually there. He witnessed what went on. So he told how Constantine forced his wording on the bishops at Nicaea, specifically the word homoousios. He said Constantine introduced it and said, you have to use this. This is the same word that the modalists use. This is the same word that was condemned 60 years previously at three separate synods at Antioch. This is the same word that Paul of Samosata used and was condemned as a heretic for. But Constantine had just issued the Edict of Milan, granting rights to Christians. They would no longer have to fear persecution. He brought all the bishops together, fed them, housed them. So how do you defy the emperor? These bishops were under enormous pressure. Eusebius continued quoting Constantine as he said, a body which is immaterial and incorporeal cannot possibly be subject to any corporeal affection. Hence, our conception of these things can only be in divine and mysterious terms. Mysterious terms. Okay, these are the words and concepts and ideas that the Hellenistic philosophers were using. This non-Christian Emperor Constantine was enforcing his own philosophies on the Christian church, and that's not even the worst problem. The biggest issue with the Nicene Creed is it actually anathematizes and condemns separate persons. Most Trinitarians today aren't even aware that there are anathemas, much less aware of what they say. I certainly wasn't aware of these anathemas for many years as I studied the Trinity. They are known to many scholars, but they don't advertise them because they are an embarrassment to the church. Anyway, I'll read the most controversial anathema. It says, those who assert that the Son of God is heterohypostasis or ousia, meaning different persons or being. These the universal and apostolic church anathematizes. Again, I'll refer to the dictionary because those are big words and we don't want any confusion. In the dictionary, the word hetero means other or different, as in heterosexual. For hypostasis, there's actually a Trinitarian heading that says each of the three persons of the Trinity as contrasted with the unity of the Godhead, as in the single person of Christ. For ousia, it means being. So the anathema says, basically, you can't call them different persons or beings, or you're a heretic. The anathemas were meant to anathematize the Arians and their heresy, but they ended up anathematizing modern-day Trinitarians too. This is one of the most direct and compelling evidences that the early Christian church fell into apostasy, because these words, heterohypostasis and ousia, they were used in an orthodox manner prior to the Council of Nicaea, and written by specifically by writers like Origen, who said they had different hypostases and ousias. So over time, those anathemas were quietly dropped as they began, as they made changes to the Nicene Creed. They started using hypostases as separate persons again, but separate beings was still a big no-no. Well, this is where Trinitarians get their ideas of God being three persons instead of beings from, through this apostasy. Even if you don't believe in the Nicene Creed, you still get your language from the Creed. It's important to understand that this is unbiblical. And today, if you say that they are separate persons, you are still committing heresy against the original Nicene Creed. Neither persons or hypostasis is in the Bible. I challenge anyone to find that for me in there. This makes the Trinity completely bankrupt. So what does the Bible actually say about God and the nature of God? Well, we can read those, read the words of those who actually gazed into heaven and saw God. Daniel has a vision, and he writes about his vision. And in Daniel 7, starting in verse 9, it says, "As I looked, thrones, plural thrones, were placed. And the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him." Well, I'd like to know one thing, have Kelly answer, is how an incorporeal being can have white clothes, white hair, and sit on a throne. Because this isn't Jesus. Jesus is not there yet in the vision. There are countless separate beings worshiping the Father as God and the Father alone as God. Jesus comes in a few verses later. He says, "I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like the Son of Man." That Son of Man, meaning Jesus. "And he came to the Ancient of Days." He came to the Father and was presented before him. "And to the Son of Man, it was given dominion and glory and a kingdom. And his dominion is an everlasting dominion." So Daniel sees God, not Jesus, God. And this isn't a one-time event. John the Beloved sees the same thing in his Revelation. And he records it even in further detail. So in Revelation, he sees, starting in chapter 4, verse 2, "Behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne." Again, how does a being who fills the universe sit on a throne? "And round about the throne were 24 seats," more thrones. "And upon these seats, I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold." And I'm going to jump to verse 11. "And the 24 elders fell down before him that sat on the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever." So they are worshiping the being that's on the throne. "And they cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created." And then you go to chapter 5, verse 1, and it says, "I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book." Again, this is strictly the Father. We know this because Jesus is not mentioned yet. Throughout the whole book of Revelation, John refers to the God as the Father alone. Never does he even hint that Jesus is God. Jesus doesn't even appear until the following chapter. So we finally see Jesus, and he comes in chapter 5, verse 6, and he says, "And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And I beheld," so that's Jesus, okay? He's not on the throne. He's down in the midst of the congregation. And he comes before the one sitting on the throne. He takes the book. And because of that, he's actually exalted and given power. And it's in verse 11 that says he was given... It says, "Worthy of the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing." So we see that John sees the Father, sees God, and he's sitting on a throne. Isaiah sees God sitting on a throne too. It says in Isaiah 6:1, he says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I also saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple." No mention of Jesus. So does Ezekiel. It says, "And above the firmament that was over their heads was the likeness of a throne, and the appearance of a sapphire stone. And upon the likeness of the throne was the likeness as the appearance of a man above upon it." That's Ezekiel 1:26. Moses and 73 others saw God too. In Exodus 24, 9 through 11, it reads, "And Moses went up with 73 others, and they saw the God of Israel. Under his feet was a work like a pavement made of sapphire, as clear as the sky itself." Now, if you go back to Ezekiel, Ezekiel describes the throne like a sapphire stone. So they're seeing God. They're seeing the Father. And it continues on. It says, "But God did not lay his hand on the nobles of Israel. They saw him and they ate and drank." Does this mean God ate and drank with them? I don't know. But it says that he had hands to lay on them, but he didn't do it. So obviously, all these men lived to tell the tale. So the scriptures that say you can't see God obviously have some qualifications to them, because these men did. Moses and the 73 priests, Ezekiel, Daniel, Isaiah, and John all saw God the Father, not Jesus, sitting on his sapphire throne with white hair, white clothes, hands, feet, and a backside to sit on. This is consistent with Genesis 1:26. It says, "We will make man in our likeness and in our image." These words, likeness and image, are important. Likeness in Hebrew is demuth. Image is Salem. These are important because when we jump over to Genesis 5, it says, "Adam fathered a son in his likeness according to his image and named him Seth." It uses the same language and the same Hebrew words, demuth and Salem. So here we have Seth, who is in the likeness and image of his father Adam, who is in the likeness and image of God. That can only mean that Seth is in the likeness and image of God in the same way Adam is. If A equals B and B equals C, then A should equal C. In other words, if you are C and you are in the likeness of and image of your father B, then in the same way you are in the likeness and image of God A. A equals B, B equals C, and A equals C. You are made in God's own image. Thank you.
Well, that was actually under 15, Robert. But good job. All right, my turn up. Cool. All right, put you on there. I'm going to reset my clock here. So we got, now we'll be doing 10 minutes. Okay. All right. Well, Robert has definitely shared some interesting things. Some things that I was anticipating, some things I thought would be a little bit more heavy hitter. But nonetheless, I'm still appreciative of what he has shared. Now, I'm not sure on all the things of what he's talking about, different creeds. I had to do a little bit of investigating on the issue of the Nicene Creed. If you just do a Google and you look up earlychurchtext.com, you can see the Creed of Nicaea. And here's what it actually says that maybe, Robert, you might want to read this later, because it's under the Nicene Creed of 325. And here's what it says in regard to the full context, okay? "We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of all things, visible and invisible. And in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, begotten from the Father, only begotten, that is, from the substance of the Father. God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one substance with the Father, through whom all things came into being, things in heaven, things on the earth, who, because of us men and because of our salvation, came down and became incarnate, became man and suffered, rose again on the third day and ascended to the heavens, and will come to judge the living and dead, and in the Holy Spirit." Notice what this does say, Robert. "But as for those who say," "there was when he was not, and before being born he was not, and that he came into existence out of nothing, or who assert that the Son of God is of a different hypostasis or substance, or created, or is subject to alteration or change. These the Catholic and Apostolic Church anathematizes." Let's read that again. "But for those who say there was when he was not. In other words, there was a time when Jesus did not exist. In the early church, you had many heretical movements, the Gnostics, the Arians, there was modalists, there was other groups that were coming against different groups, different views out there that were coming against the knowledge and understanding what the scriptures taught about the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And people were teaching different things about the nature and substance, particularly about Jesus's eternity. There was a debate. Is Jesus eternally the Son or not? Modalists reject that, and they're false, and they've been misguided. So what the statement here by the creed says, if someone comes and says there was a time when Jesus was not, Mormonism teaches there was a time when Jesus was not. He wasn't always God, eternally God. He was first man who became a God. That fits in this right here, that he came into existence out of nothing. Jehovah's Witnesses teach that. Those who assert that the Son of God is a different hypostasis or substance. This is the big difference right here. The word persons is not used here directly. Talking about a different substance, because Christians, those of us who believe in the triunity of God, we believe that there is one eternal God. I shared that. Psalm 90, verse 2, from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Deuteronomy 6, 4, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You see, the Bible, Old and New Testament, affirms that there is one God. You see, but when Jesus came, Jesus, who was by nature God, it says in Philippians 2, 5, and 6, who being in the form of God, morphe is the Greek word for nature. Jesus, who was by nature God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be clinged to or grasped, but for a time he humbled himself, came to this earth as creator God from eternity, not a spirit child from a heavenly father and heavenly mother, but the eternal creator. He came and took on our likeness. That's the nature. That's the substance right there. Jesus was by nature God, just like the Father. The Father never had a beginning. The Father was not, there was not a time when the Father did not, was not God. Same thing with Jesus. Same thing with the Holy Spirit. Jesus said the Holy Spirit would come, that he would be sent. John 14, verse 16. Jesus said, I will pray to the Father that he will send another helper. That word another in Greek is the Greek word allos. Allos means another of the same nature, same kind. That word comforter is the Greek word parakleto, which means another advocate. Jesus was sent from the Father. The Holy Spirit would be sent. They are all by nature eternal. They are all by nature the one being, if you will. But I looked up just quickly for the time of hand here, looking up the word person and being. I just went to a couple. Miriam says the word person means someone of a specified individual. Being, quality, or the state of existence. I went to dictionary.com. Look up the word again, person. Something that was self-conscious or the rational character of being. Then the word being I looked up. Something existence, substance, or nature, or a living thing. So here's the thing. When Christians, when we use words like persons, it's a way to identify how the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are distinct. This is something we do have in common with LDS. We do believe. We reject modalism. We do reject other things. We don't believe in modes. We believe that Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit are distinct from one another. But here's the difference. As I pointed out, Joseph Smith claims that God has not been God from all eternity. He, in fact, says, I will refute that idea and take away the veil. And by doing this, I will prove to the world that I'm a true teacher of God. He goes on to say, here then is eternal life, to know the only wise and true God. You've got to learn how to be God yourselves, to be kings and priests to God, the same as all the gods have gone before you, from going from one small degree to another. Exaltation to exaltation. You see, this is the doctrine of the LDS Godhead, that God has not always been God. But in fact, at some point, he was a man, and he had a father, and his father became a God, and his father. Endless progression. Same thing with Jesus. You see, we read in the Book of Mormon, numerous places. Let me read these one more time. This is important. Let me read this again. I got my notes up now. I can see a little bit better. It says here in Mormon 9:9, "For do we not read that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever? In him there's no variable, a variableness, neither shadow of changing. And now, if we have imagined up to ourselves a God that does vary, and in whom there's shadow of changing, then you've imagined yourself a God who is not the God of miracles." Right there, it's stating, if you think that there's a shadow in God, that God somehow evolves or at some point progresses to become a God, that's not right. "For I know that God is not a partial God, neither a changeable being. From all eternity to all eternity." Moroni 8:18. Let me share the one that I was trying to find before. This is 2 Nephi 31:20-21. It says this: "Wherefore ye must press forward with a steadfast in Christ, having a perfect brightness of hope, the love of God and of all men. Wherefore, if you press forward, feasting upon the word of Christ, endure to the end. Behold, thus saith the Father, ye shall have eternal life. And now behold, my beloved brethren, this is the way. There is no other name given under heaven by which can be saved in the kingdom of God. And now behold, this is the doctrine of Christ, the only true doctrine of the Father, and of the Son and the Holy Ghost, which is one God without end." You see, and it goes on to say, Doctrine and Covenants 20:28, which the Father, the Son, and Holy Ghost are one God, infinite, eternal, without end. Amen. You see, what's interesting is Joseph Smith's teaching and the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints have been deceived. Satan was a fallen angel. Satan, according to the book of Ezekiel 14, fell from heaven. He wanted to exalt himself as like a God, and God said, "We're not going to have it," and he fell. What was the first sin in the Garden of Eve with Adam and Eve? The devil deceived Adam. He was thinking, "You won't surely die. If you eat of that, you'll be just like God, knowing good and evil." Temptation. The sin that that Joseph Smith taught, deception, is that man was first the father, and that he became a God and progression of God. But yet the Bible teaches unequivocally that God has always been God, and he's been revealed as the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. My time is up. Bring you up here. Sorry about that. Rob.
Okay, we on? All right. Getting some feedback here. Okay. Start my 10 minutes. I feel like I'm all alone here.
You're good to go.
Okay. Okay. You are there. All right. A lot of what Kelly brought up was it's a misunderstanding of our theology. He says that he quotes the King Follett Discourse and says, "He was once a man like us, yea, that God himself, the father of us all, dwelt on an earth." So he takes it, and a lot of people do this, even LDS people do this. They take it out of context. They kind of chop it off right there. I'm going to continue the context because context is important. It says, "He was once a man like us, yea, that God himself, the father of us all, dwelt on an earth, the same as Jesus Christ himself did. And I will show it from the Bible." And he goes on and he quotes, or he uses these references for, pulls this doctrine out of the Bible. And he says, the scriptures inform us that Jesus said, "As the Father hath power in himself," he's referring to John 5:26. He says, even so the Son hath power to do what? Why, what the Father did. In a manner to lay down his body and take it up again. Jesus, what are you going to do? To lay down my life as my father did and take it up again, referring to John 10:18. What did Jesus do? Why, I do the same things I saw my fathers do when the worlds came rolling into existence. He was referring to John 5:19, which says, I can do nothing save what I have seen my father do. So he's actually taking these doctrines from the Bible, and Protestants don't have an interpretation for them. We do. We know what, or we believe that Heavenly Father was basically the God and Savior of his planet. So just as you believe that God, that Jesus was God before, he was God on earth and God after, the same thing applies to God as the Father before, God on his planet and God after. Well, Jesus changed. You believe that God changed. He added humanity to himself. He didn't have humanity before. He came down, lived as man, and changed. That's a huge change. So the question isn't, is God unchangeable? It's how does he change or how doesn't he change? God does change. He added humanity. Big change. We also believe that Jesus wasn't created. God wasn't created. Joseph Smith kind of fixed that. There was the Arian problem. They believed that Jesus was created. There was a time when Jesus didn't exist. However, we believe that intelligence or intelligences were never created. This is quoted in the D&C 93 verses 29 through 30. And it says, man was also in the beginning with God. Intelligence or the light of truth was not created or made. Neither indeed can it be. So Jesus created everything. He made everything that was made. He didn't make intelligence. Intelligence was not created or made. We were intelligence. We were always the part of us that exists, the I am part of us that exists, that's intelligence. And I can kind of point to my intelligence that that exists within me, but that intelligence was added to spirit, and then it was added to a body. We are spiritual beings who are going through a temporal existence, not temporal beings going through or having a spiritual existence or a spiritual experience. So as members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, we believe that the Bible, as far as it's translated correctly. And I'm going to demonstrate how badly the Bible gets mistranslated and misinterpreted. As I said before in Revelation, John doesn't ever say that Jesus is God. And in Revelation 1:6, the King James Version says, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. Now, this sounds like Jesus is God and has a Father. However, it's not the correct translation. All the other translations say, made us a kingdom and priest to his God and Father. So we are priests to Jesus's God and Father. So here's another bad translation. And a lot of Trinitarians quote this against the LDS Church in John 4:24, where it says, God is a spirit. That's a wrong translation. All the other translations say God is spirit, not a spirit. And you have to finish out the verse in the context to say that you must worship him in spirit. Are you a spirit? No, you also have a body, but God is spirit in the same way you are spirit. And again, we are spiritual beings going through a temporal existence. You brought up John 1:1, and this is one of the worst verses that are massacred by Trinitarians. In the Greek, it reads, in arche in ho logos, in the beginning was the word, kai ho logos in proston theon, the word was with the God, ton theon, kai theos en ho logos, and a God was the word. That's the literal translation. So are you familiar with the Greek ton theon? Theon is the accusative case of theos. The accusative case refers to the direct object. It's like the difference between any man and the man. When you say the man upstairs wants to see you, you know that you are not going upstairs to see the janitor. So ton theon means the God. And theos means another divine being. The God upstairs isn't the janitor. He's the Father. So John 1:1 doesn't say Jesus is God, but it actually demonstrates that he is a divine being who is with the Father, showing that there are two separate divine beings in the original Greek. John 1:1 is actually the greatest verse supporting LDS theology. And this isn't just my interpretation. Reverend John L. McKenzie, a Catholic biblical scholar, in his dictionary 60 years ago, wrote that John 1:1 should be rigorously translated, "The Word was with the God," meaning the Father, "and the Word was a divine being." This is important because Jesus is never known as Ton Theon in the entire Bible, not once. It's always reserved for the God who is the Father. This is why the Father is who sits on the throne, not Jesus. Now, Jesus is clearly a divine being, but he is a God, another God, an exalted deity, but he is a God under the God. He is a God that has a God above him. And this is demonstrated over and over in the Bible. We have to use other translations, though, because the King James Version doesn't always translate them properly. I already gave Revelation 1:6, but again, it says, "He has made us priests to his God and Father," meaning Jesus has a God. In John 20:17, he's talking to Mary, and he says, "Touch me not, for I have not ascended unto my Father." He says, "I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God, Theon, and your God, Theon," meaning Jesus and us have the same God. Romans 15:6, "That you may glorify the God, Ton Theon, and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Jesus Christ has a Father and a God. 2 Corinthians 1:3, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Peter echoes Paul. 1 Peter 1:3, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." John 17:3, "Now this is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God, Ton Monon, Alephanon Theon, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." I hope I'm getting my point across, that Jesus was not thought of as God. He was a divine being, but Heavenly Father was God. So there's no question about being divine beings. What separates them is their rank and titles. Jesus is above all other divine beings, and Father and the Father is above him. So Jesus is a God who has a God. This is you brought up a couple of verses in the Old Testament. And when we look at those, again, it's a problem with the mistranslations and misunderstanding the text. The word Elohim is a plural word. It's used more than 2,500 times throughout the Old Testament. Elohim is a collective of Eloah. Elohim is gods. Eloah is the singular form of God. And this is similar to Allah. Eloah, Allah. Muslims use Allah. Hebrews use Eloah. So Eloah is a single divine being, and it's only used about 300 times. It is the divine counsel of Elohim that Psalms 82:1 talks about. The Elohim stood in the presence of El, the God, and he judged among the Elohim. So the Elohim are gods. You brought up Isaiah, but Isaiah uses poetic language to describe God. In Isaiah 40:22, he says that the earth is a round circle. Well, we know that the earth is not a two-dimensional round circle, and he uses that language instead of ball. Ball is used in Isaiah 22. So we know that scientifically that Isaiah was using a poetic language to see how God sees the earth. He also uses that in other, a little later, he says, to describe cities. He says, "I am Babylon and none else beside me." Well, we know that Isaiah is not saying there's no other cities than Babylon. No, he's using poetic language. So God is using, or Isaiah is using this language to describe incomparability. And I understand my time is up, so I'll kind of go ahead and leave it there. But these verses don't say what you think they're saying.
All right, I didn't mind letting you go a little bit longer there, Robert, no problem. All right, so I'm going to put my clock on here. We both got 5 minutes each still. How do I do this in 5 minutes? All right. Starting my clock. All right. So you have shared lots in regards to John chapter 5. And you shared how that's what Joseph Smith was making reference to the Father. So you openly acknowledged what Joseph Smith said, that Jesus came and gave his life. So the Father at some point gave his life. So the Father according to LDS doctrine, was once a man who came into a world, died upon a cross, rose again, just like Jesus. So he was a man. So therefore, at some point, the Father was not God. And according to you, Jesus was not God until after he was resurrected, okay? And he progressed to be a God. When you look at John chapter 5, what Jesus is teaching is that he was sent from the Father. He spoke the words of the Father. Again, you need to understand, if you, in your video that you have on your channel, you said you understand modalism. This is not modalism. I have clearly, unequivocally stated that Trinitarians believe in distinctions of person. So when Jesus was here, the Father's in the heavenly realm. Jesus is not literally the Father. You're using arguments against modalism. It's interesting what you did there. I don't understand why you even went down that rabbit trail. Also, you said Jesus never is called God by John in the book of Revelation. Are you kidding me? Revelation chapter 1. Look at this over here. For the sake of time, we got to move fast here, folks. Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1, verse 7 and 8. Let's look at it real quickly here. Verse 7 and 8. Behold, he cometh with the clouds, and every eye shall see him, and those who pierced him, all the kingdoms of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is, which was, which is to come, the Almighty. This is the Alpha and the Omega. Now, there is a dispute. Some people want to say, oh, that's talking about the Father. But is the Father coming back to return the second time? Nope. Jesus is the one coming back. And then go back here to verse 17. It says, Jesus or John, when he sees him, I saw him. I fell at his feet as dead, laid his right hand upon me, saying, fear not. I am the first and I am the last. That's chapter 1. Fast forward to chapter 22. Look at chapter 22. 22, who's the one coming? Jesus is the one coming. Revelation chapter 22, verse 12. Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give to every man according to what his work shall be. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. The first and the last. Notice verse 20. He which testifies to these things says, surely I cometh quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Jesus is the Alpha, the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He is the God. So that right there refuted you right quickly. You talk about Greek in John chapter 1. I don't know what you've been smoking on that one. Which Greek text, literal Greek interlinear, says that the word was a God? I want to know which interlinear says that. There is no A in the Greek. Also, to point out, proston theon literally means that he, Jesus, was face to face. Proston theon means that he was face to face with the Father. John 1:1 is not trying to teach Jesus is the Father. That's why it says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, verse 14. So we know the Word is speaking about Jesus. So the Word, in the beginning, was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was with God. The Word was face to face with God. Who's that being talked about? Verse 18, that's talking about the Father. So Jesus Christ, the eternal Son, was with the Father in the very beginning. And when you read John 1:3, what does it teach? John 1:3 says the following. John 1:3, hurrying fast, your time is flying like gangbusters. All things that were made by him, without him, not even one thing that was made. All things came into existence. Jesus Christ created. In fact, this proves, again, the triunity of God. You talk about other verses that really are like trying to prove Unitarianism, Jehovah's Witnesses theology. Compare John 17:3. If you want to believe that Jesus is not God, not a very good idea. 1 John chapter 5, verse 20, John the Apostle writes, this is eternal life and the true God, pointing them to Jesus Christ. The Father is the true God. Jesus Christ came to reveal the Father. He came to show the world the Father. Jesus Christ said that the Holy Spirit would be by nature of the same substance as him. Therefore, this proves unequivocally that Old and New Testament teaches that there's one eternal God, who has been revealed in three distinct persons, as I've already pointed out, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And what blows my mind, Robert, is the very scriptures that Joseph Smith apparently was translated through inspiration by God in the Book of Mormon and even things that he was supposed to teach in Doctrine and Covenants actually refutes what he claimed in the King Follett discourse. All right, when again, 30 seconds over, we'll bring you up. You may go.
All right, thank you. Okay. So first of all, we don't believe that Jesus was not God until after his resurrection. We believe that Jesus was God before, that he was God while on the earth, and that he was God while after he was resurrected. We believe that his intelligence was not created. The thing that makes him his I am, the thing that makes him, the thing that makes you, your intelligences, our intelligences were not created. You pointed to Revelation and said, nothing you said in there means God. The first and last isn't ton theon. The Alpha and the Omega is not ton theon. Yes, it's an important rank. It's an important title, but it's not the God. It's not ton theon. The God in John 1:1 is ton theon. Yes, he was face to face with the Father. So there are two people. You can't be with yourself. There's two people there, two divine beings. And the reason the reason he's called a God is because in Greek, Greek doesn't have the indefinite article a. All it has is the definite article the. The is tone, ho, and there's another form too. That's the. When it lacks the word the, it can automatically be referred to as a. So Jesus was a divine being. It doesn't say ton theon about Jesus. It doesn't have ho theos as Jesus. It has just theos. It's lacking the article. It lacks the, which then it can be translated. It's supposed to be translated as a. Now, again, this isn't just my translation. The Catholic father that I quoted, he's Catholic. He's not Jehovah's Witness. He was just an honest scholar. So when he says that the word was a divine being, he says that that's the way it should be rigorously translated. But he was a divine being. That's where what separates the Jehovah's Witnesses is they don't believe he was a divine being. And he was just an angel. So let's see. I think I addressed pretty much everything I need to. Go back to Isaiah and the schema. The Lord our God is one Lord. It doesn't say one God. It says they're one Lord. So you don't have anything that just says there's one God. Monotheism is not the same monotheism that you understand it to the early Christian church. They were monotheists because they believed in that the Father alone was God and that Jesus was a divine being. Justin Martyr actually has a dialogue with a monotheistic Jew. And he's actually arguing against the monotheistic Jew that says, we believe there's another God. And he says, I'm going to prove it to you. And he starts going through much of the same. I listened to your video on what you believe God to be and how there are two Yahwehs. And Justin Martyr uses this to show that there are two divine beings in the Old Testament. There's two Yahwehs and they interact with each other. And so, we can show from the Bible that there are two divine beings.
You're done?
I'm done.
All right. All right. Well, that concludes our openings and going back and forth in regards to what we wanted to share. So, to keep it fair, because I want to be fair with you, there's lots of things that I'm sure we both would like to jump on. So you were just kind of in a way talking about John 1:1 on Proston Theon and how other places in reference to Jesus. And you even used just a moment ago the Greek hathios, that Jesus is not called the God, correct?
That's correct.
So are you familiar with John 20:28?
I am.
So what does it say in the Greek there?
I don't have it in front of me. You'll have to read it to me.
What interlinear were you reading from a little while ago that you were trying to articulate your thoughts from John 1:1?
I use Bible Hub, and I had that already written down.
Okay. Because I'm using Bible Hub, too, but I have no idea what you were talking about. It didn't match what Bible Hub interlinear shows, so that's why I was curious. But if you were to look with Bible Hub and you go to John 20:28, this is what it actually states about Jesus. I'll read it from the interlinear. It says, "Answered Thomas and said to him, the Lord of me and the God of me." And in the Greek, it is the words ha theos. Mm-hmm. So it literally is the Kyrios of me and hos theos of me. And that is Thomas speaking to Jesus.
Right. Now notice that it doesn't say ton theon. There's a difference between the nominative.
There's not
Greek.
Every reference is going to say theon, though. There's plenty of references that talk about theos, theon. That's the point.
It doesn't matter. Theon is the accusative form. Accusative form means, like I say, it's like the man upstairs. When you're talking about the CEO, you say the man. So we use accusative in English, but we use it in emphasis.
So let's back up for a second. So I actually think you're refuting yourself, Robert. You just don't realize it. So in John 1:1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word with God, and the Word was God." Literally, it's teaching that Jesus was with the Father in the very beginning, so that we have an agreement that there are two distinct persons. But as you said a minute ago, nowhere is Jesus ever called hostheos. And yet, I just point out to you.
No, I didn't say I did not say he was never called hostheos.
Yes,
I never said he was called using the nominative hostheos.
That's why I said it. I wrote it down.
I said ton theon.
No, but you said also he was never called hostheos. You said
that. I didn't say that.
Yes, you did.
I didn't say that.
I wrote it down.
You misheard me then because I did.
So let me ask you a question. So how can Jesus be called the God of me by Thomas and not be God?
Because in the nominative form, it's kind of the generic form. So Jesus is the God of Thomas, okay? But he's not the God.
So which God are we supposed to serve?
Well, we serve by serving Jesus, we serve the Heavenly Father.
Are we supposed to serve one God or just the Father or just Jesus? How does it work?
They're a unity, just like you believe. They're a unity. So when we serve Jesus, we are actually serving our God, because he does nothing. He does nothing without what the Heavenly Father says. He does the Father's will. Everything he does is the Father's will.
So let me ask you a question. So you believe that Jesus is God, correct?
Yes.
When
but
did
clarify
you
that?
What's that?
But clarify that. Again, he is a God that has a God.
Okay, but is Jesus right now God?
That's a difficult, because we have to understand what we're saying by God. So if I say Jesus is God, yes, we can worship him as God, because they are one in a line, the Holy Ghost. In fact, we don't even have access to Jesus. All we have access to is the Holy Ghost. So when we feel the Holy Ghost, we're actually in line with Jesus. It's a parallel. They go like this. They're not side by side. They're parallel.
So in the Old Testament, help me out here. Who is the God of the Old Testament?
So in the Old Testament, Heavenly Father, God, is the God. Jesus is who we see, or is who he's the Word. So when God speaks, Jesus is the one that delivers the message.
So again, my question on the Old Testament, who is the God of the Old Testament? Who is the Elohim that you believe in the Old Testament?
When the Father speaks, Jesus is the one that delivers the message. So Jesus is the one that we recognize or see, because the Heavenly Father is the Father. He was separated because of the fall. When Adam fell, we didn't have access to the Father. All we had access to was the mediator between man and God.
All right. I'm just going to ask you. So in the Old Testament, I'm again asking, who is the God of the Old Testament? What is a scripture reference that shares with me and the audience? Who is the God of the Old Testament? Where would you point us to?
I would say that Jesus is the God of the Old Testament because he's who we see. But he's the God. He's the God we see. There's the God above him who sends him.
So in the Old Testament, Jesus is the God of the Old Testament, not the Father?
I would say yes.
All right, I'm confused.
I know you are.
So then who is the Father in the Old Testament?
The Father is the Ancient of Days. He's the one who Daniel saw sitting on the throne. He's the one who Ezekiel saw standing above the throne. He's the one who Moses in the 73 saw standing on the sapphire stone.
All right, so you know that the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints official doctrine teaching is that the Elohim in the Old Testament is the Father, and that Jehovah or the Lord is Jesus. You know that, right?
Yes, I do.
Do you agree with that?
I didn't say anything that I disagree with.
You just disagreed with that completely because you said that Jesus is the God of the Old Testament, and that and you didn't make that clear on the Father. So let me ask you a question.
I'm making it very clear by stating that Jesus is the God that we see in the Old Testament.
Okay, that's however, not my question. I said in the Old Testament, who is the Elohim in the Old Testament according to you?
Well, in the Old Testament, when we look at the Elohim, that is a plural of gods. So the Elohim
are there many fathers then? So when you speak of God the Father, there's many fathers?
There are many divine beings. They don't have the title of father.
Because the elder teaches Hold on, Robert. The LDS official teaching is Elohim in the Old Testament is the Father. So I'm asking you again, if you're talking about this plurality, that's a different thing. I'm asking you, do you agree with the LDS official teaching that in the Old Testament, when it talks about God being the Elohim, that's the Father?
The Elohim in Hebrew is gods, period. That's what Elohim means. In the LDS church, we don't necessarily equate Elohim in the Hebrew with our Father. Father is a title.
Let me be more direct. Can you point a reference in the Old Testament where it talks about God the Father? Where would you point a scripture in the Old Testament from your point of view that talks about God the Father?
Several. When Adam walked with God, that was the Father. When Daniel saw the Ancient of Days, that was the Father.
Can you give me an exact reference? Like, give me a reference. A direct reference. An exact reference. I want to read it with you.
Okay.
Where are we at?
All right. Well, let's look at Daniel. I've already brought up Daniel 7, verse 9.
All right, so Daniel 7, verse 9,
the Genesis.
Is going to talk about that God is the Father. That's my question again. My direct question to you, Robert, is where do we read about the Father, God the Father, in the Old Testament? So you're pointing me to Daniel chapter 7? Correct? Can you hear me?
Yes.
So where are we at?
Yes. Daniel chapter 7.
Okay.
Verse 9.
Okay, you read it for me, please.
I read it for you. Hang on. All right. And there were thrones. As I looked, thrones, plural, were placed. And the Ancient of Days took his seat. And his clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. That's not Jesus. That's not Jehovah. That's the Ancient of Days. That's God.
Okay, and again, respectfully, I'm asking for you to point me to a verse in the Old Testament where the Father is called God, Elohim.
Oh, no. See,
That was my question.
Okay, where is God pointed to in Elohim? I misunderstood your question then, because Genesis 1:26 Elohim is called God specifically. Genesis 1:26.
Let's go there. Genesis 1:26. I'm wanting you to explain to me what you believe. That's what I'm trying to do right now. I'm letting you explain what you believe.
All right, ready?
There, you tell me. So I'm there. You tell me what's going on.
And God said, and Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the air, and et cetera, et cetera. So let us make man in our image, after our likeness. That is Elohim speaking, saying, let us make man.
And that's directly the Father here is what you're saying?
That is the Father. That is not the Son.
So the Father said, let us. So who's the us?
Well, with every father, there must be a mother. So it says, let us make man in our image. And he's not saying, let's make a man. He says, let's make man, as in humanity, in our image. So when we speak of a father, we are speaking of one flesh, marriage, meaning father and mother. We just don't actually identify her with that. But that is who's speaking.
So correct me if I'm wrong. You just like dropped my jaw here. My jaw is on the floor right now. I was not expecting that answer from you. So you believe, according to Genesis 1:26, that it's God here is the Father. And it said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, let them rule over the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image, and the image of God created him, male and female created he them.
Yep.
You are saying, if I understand correctly, you're saying the us and the our here is the Father and a heavenly mother, and this is teaching procreation. Is that correct?
I don't know how they did it. I'm not saying that it teaches procreation. I'm saying that Heavenly Father, or in this particular verse, there is a unity between two beings that created male and female after their likeness. And again, when you look at Seth being created in the likeness of his father, it's the same text, the same wording. So Seth was created, if you look in Genesis 5:1-3, Seth was created in the likeness and image of his father Adam, in the same way Adam was created in the likeness and image of his father, and Eve as a woman was created in the likeness and image of her mother.
All right, so this is very fascinating stuff to me, Robert. I have to completely admit to you, I need to grab some popcorn and a pop for you to explain this to me. I feel like I'm now at a movie and I'm trying to understand this drama that's about to take place. Because when I read this here, it says, so verse 27, so God created man in his own image, and in the image of God, he created him, male and female. So God is the one who created both Adam and Eve. And according to Genesis 2:7, it says the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And then later in Genesis 2:21, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept and took one of his ribs and closed up his flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken of man. Robert, I don't know how in the world you would get from Genesis 1:26 that there is a heavenly father and a heavenly mother involved in the creation of Adam and Eve.
Do you believe Adam and Eve were one flesh?
Yeah, Genesis 2:24 says that.
Okay. In the same way, Adam, or our heavenly mother, is one flesh, one collective noun with our heavenly father. They are known as one. There are... the Jews actually worshipped a heavenly mother for a while. Her name was known as Asherah.
Okay, well, hold on a second. So let me just ask you a follow-up question here, because this is, again, this is popcorn worthy. So just for a second, I just need to ask you this. So over in Isaiah, let me ask you this question here. Let me turn to it real quick. Isaiah 44. Let me read a couple of passages here just to give a little context, and then I'll ask you to give a response if that's okay. Isaiah 44. Let me get to it here, please. 44. All right, that's for another discussion there. I'm not going to go to verse 8 right now. I was already on that one earlier. Let me just start in verse 21. Isaiah 44, verse 21. Remember these, O Jacob and Israel, for thou art my servant. I have formed thee, and thou art my servant, O Israel. Thou hast not forgotten of me. I have blotted out as a thick cloud thy transgressions, and as a cloud thy sins return unto me, for I have returned, or sorry, I have redeemed thee. Sing, O ye heavens, for the Lord hast done it. Shout, ye lower parts of the earth. Break forth into singing, ye mountains of forest, and every tree therein of the Lord hast redeemed Jacob and glorified himself in Israel. Look at verse 24, and I want to ask you to answer this according to what you just said a moment ago. Thus says the Lord, thy Redeemer, and he that formed thee from the womb. I am the Lord that maketh all things, that stretched forth the heavens alone, and spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. How do you reconcile that with what you just shared about there being a heavenly father and a heavenly mother being involved in creation?
Again, Adam and Eve were one flesh. Isaiah uses poetic language. He's not describing reality here. He's describing how he can poetically say his reality. So again, this goes back to, is the earth a round circle? In Isaiah 40, verse 20, that's only four chapters away, he's using the same word for a flat circle of the earth. Well, we know that the earth isn't a flat circle. So we know that this section of Isaiah is very poetic. It's not, we can't take these things literally. He uses it to describe things, but we can't use it literally.
So I'm not really sure where you're getting that from, because in verse 20 it talks about the circle of the earth, and which means a sphere. So
it doesn't mean a sphere. No, yes, it means a flat circle. It is a two-dimensional circle.
That's wrong. But I want to get back to Isaiah 44, Robert. This is the text. The Lord says the Lord is the one that made all things by himself. Now, I'm just going to be completely open and honest with you. Only from the Christian point of view does this make any sense. How I've already shared earlier, how the Father, the Son, Holy Spirit are all by nature God. What you just said a moment ago is definitely something interesting, because I wasn't even expecting this conversation to go this direction at all, to be honest with you. But I'm happy it did in regards to learning new information. When you just said a moment ago in Genesis 1:26, God said, let us make man in our image. This is news to me. Is this official LDS interpretation of this verse, or is it just you?
I don't represent the LDS church, but this is the way I understand it. Yes.
This is what you've been taught by the church, though. This is what this means.
No, this is my own understanding. I have not been taught this by the LDS church. They do not translate.
LDS prophet or apostle has ever said these words that you just said.
I don't know if they did. I don't know if they didn't.
Okay. Fair enough. I just want to know, because you know, you are one thing about you are, Robert, you are different than other LDS people. This is true. This is the good thing about you. I do like that, because you do bring something new to the table. That's for sure. Let me ask you a question on the word God, though. In Deuteronomy 6:4, I shared this earlier, and I would be just tickled to hear your interpretation of this in light of what you've been sharing already. And it's nothing new. I'm sure you're familiar with this a little bit already. In verse 4, it says this: "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord." Now, again, this is important, and I know you may have a different answer, but this is important for me to point out for anyone listening, and any LDS know this. The Lord here is Jehovah in the context, and Elohim is in reference to Yahweh. So if I was to read this from that perspective, "Hear, O Israel, the Jehovah, our God, is one Jehovah," or "Jesus, our Elohim," or "our Father, is Jehovah." How do you reconcile this text of Isaiah 6:4, where it would seem to be indicating that Jesus is in fact Elohim, the Father, according to LDS doctrine?
So this is known as the Jewish schema. And Shema, however you want to say it. And
the official pronunciation, yeah.
Okay. And this is not saying that there is one God. This is saying that the Lord God is one Lord. So out of all the gods that are out there, Yahweh is our Lord. He is the one that we worship, the one that we follow. It's not saying that there's nothing in there that says there aren't other gods. Nothing. It's that Yahweh is the Lord. He is the one that we follow.
But that, again, I actually kind of, in a way, would actually have some agreement with what you just said in that context. The difference, though, I'm just trying to understand, again, because of, again, I know you've been an apologist, if you want to call it in those words, for the LDS faith for years. I've been in counter-code apologetics for since the early 90s. So I've studied, I have literature. And everything that I've ever read from Latter-day Saints official teachings, when you read in the Old Testament, Lord, or all caps, which is Jehovah, that is a reference to Jesus. And when you read Elohim or God, that is in reference to the Father. So again, when I read this, it says, the Lord, Jesus, our Father, is one Lord. It's confusing if I was to read that with the LDS understanding of how those words are interpreted. So I'm trying to ask you maybe to give what you think, how that would be.
Again, I believe I answered this, is that the Lord is one Lord, but it doesn't say Father. There's nothing in there that says Father. It is Yahweh.
Well, I agree with you there. Yeah, I agree with you there.
Okay. And it doesn't say that there aren't other gods or there can't be other gods. It doesn't say that either.
Okay.
It just says the Lord our God Yahweh, they name him Yahweh, is one Lord. He is our Lord. He is the one that we are to follow.
All right. I guess we'll leave. I don't want to labor too everything too hard on that one, but let me ask you another question.
So my turn to ask you a question.
All right, there you go.
So you read the Creed of Nicaea of 325, and actually that is the best place where you can actually see the anathemas within the Nicene Creed. A lot of places don't list the anathemas. So you actually read that those who assert that the Son of God is of a different hypostasis or substance,
correct,
is anathematized by, and it says Catholic, but Catholic just means universal. So
correct.
The universal and apostolic church anathematizes.
Correct.
So how do you not get, how do you differentiate hypostasis from person?
Well, let me go to it. Let me just read this again, because this is really important. I still have it on my screen for anyone who wants to look it up.
It's under early. Yep.
Yeah. What I found interesting, though, is what you shared, you left out information. And I find that peculiar, because
before, I just did that for time.
But even in your video, I watched your video and you didn't have that in there either. And so I found that peculiar. But what it says over here, but as for those who say there was when he was not, and before being born, he was not, and that he came into existence out of nothing, or who assert that the Son of God is a different hypostasis or substance, or created, or subject to alteration or change, these the Catholic and Apostolic Church anathematizes. So I find this interesting, because it didn't say what you said, even in your opening earlier, about those who believe in three persons. That's not what this is stating. It's stating that those who say Jesus and the Father have a different nature, a different substance. And that was a debate.
That's in the
church. Give me one second here. That was a debate why certain creeds actually arose. Because within certain people back in those days, certain church fathers had to defend who Jesus was eternally, had to defend his deity against false teachers. So I actually get this. I think it's actually great. I think it makes sense because they're standing up for what does the Bible teach about the Jesus of the Bible compared to false teachers. So I don't see how this, as you were trying to say, when someone said they believe in three persons, that as a Trinitarian, we would be anathematized, because that's not what this is stating at all. Let me ask you to ask me the question again. What is your exact question one more time?
All right. It says those who assert, and this is an or, okay? So it's not saying, it's not making a list of things that you have to believe to be anathematized. It says, if you believe one of these things, or who assert. So if you assert that the Son of God is of a different hypostasis. So when I go to read the word hypostasis in the dictionary, it says as a Trinitarian, it's a person of God. So when you separate them, a different person, when you're saying that they're different persons, how is that not being anathematized here?
Well, because as I mentioned earlier, and this is important, we use the word persons to identify distinctions. That's the basic way to put how the word persons comes into play. And as I pointed out before, looking even up the word person online, it gives different ways of how that can be identified. And there's some that are very basic, but it talks about, self-conscious, self-existence, rational being, things like this. So for a Christian myself who does believe the Bible, both Old and New Testament, as I've already shared many scriptures already before, demonstrate that the Father is eternal, holy, uncreated, from everlasting. Same thing with Jesus. Jesus was with the Father from the very beginning. He is uncreated. In fact, he's the very source of all creation. Talks about that in Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. So Jesus, when he said he came to reveal the Father, he was the Word of God that took on flesh. Philippians chapter 2, verse 6 says, who being in the form of God, as I mentioned before, that word form is the Greek word morphe, which means nature. So Jesus was by nature God before he even took on flesh. He was with the Father before he came to this world, took on our flesh, took on our likeness as a man, but he was by nature God prior to that. He came to this world. He was still deity in bodily form. Hebrews 1:3 talks about that he was the exact express image of God, which if you know a little bit what you're talking about, you're trying to sound very Greek. Hupostasis correctar means he's the very substance or nature of God embodied. That's the hypostatic union. Jesus also talked about the Holy Spirit in John chapter 14. He said that I will pray to the Father that he will send another helper. As I mentioned before, that word another in Greek is the Greek word allos, which means another of the same kind or the same nature. That word comforter is the Greek word paraclete, means another advocate, which is the Holy Spirit. So when you put in so many words, I'll wrap it up here. When you understand that Jesus was by nature God with the Father, the Holy Spirit is by nature God with Jesus and the Father. This teaches what we call the triunity of God. Now, again, as I mentioned earlier, when we read the Bible, we don't have to understand every single detail. And I think you would even agree with me there. But we have to at least come to a grip of what does the Bible teach? And that's what I've been sharing with you so far. I can explain it to you, but I can't understand it for you. In other words, I can share with these scriptures teach what they clearly state. But that answers your question in regards to the substance and the person question.
Well, it doesn't. But so that we're not questioning that they share the same nature. There's only one divine nature. God has a divine nature. There's no other separate divine nature. They weren't arguing that in the original church. So when in 1 Peter 1:4, it says that we will be partakers of the divine nature. And I don't want to get into 2 Peter 1:4. You're right. We are going to be partakers of the divine nature. There's only one divine nature that exists, and that is what the nature are, that they are God. So the Creed of Nicaea was not trying to dispute that they were separate natures, that they had, there's only one divine nature. Jesus doesn't have a separate nature.
Who were, right, Robert? There were people who were teaching that, and that's what the point of the creed was addressing.
No, there weren't. That's the whole point. See, that's
Gnosticism actually taught this. Listen. Gnosticism actually taught that Jesus was divine only by spirit, but his flesh was not, because flesh or material is all evil. Therefore, yes. Gnosticism was contrary to the clear.
But they weren't arguing Gnosticism or against Gnosticicism. The Creed of Nicaea had nothing to do with Gnosticism. They weren't addressing Gnosticism.
It goes to what you said. There was various groups, Arianism, groups,
sure,
that taught contrary things, that Jesus was created, his flesh wasn't God, but his spirit was. There was a lot of different things. That's why there was so much clarification on, if these people teach there's a different substance, they are teaching another Jesus. And that's right. Really important to understand.
So I'm referring to the early Christian church in Orthodoxy. I'm not talking about the heretical groups. That's what I'm talking about, is that the Orthodox Christian teachers, they weren't addressing different natures. They didn't believe in different natures. Origen didn't. He says that there are three hypostases, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And only we recognize that only the Father is uncreated.
Well, he was actually a heretic. I don't agree. He was actually a good teacher at all. So,
well,
he was
Orthodox. But my point is that it was Orthodoxy that they were teaching separate hypostases. Okay. The Nicene Creed. You don't agree with that?
No, there was false teachers back in the first few centuries. That's what the creeds eventually were formulated to address, because there was false teachings going on. That's nothing new. That's not new information.
Can you name me one person that was teaching that were the same hypostases?
Well, modalism came out. Modalism was teaching that Jesus was literally the Father.
That was condemned.
Yeah, but that's, again, teaching that he was something different, a different kind of change or different substance. There's a whole whack of worms, that can of worms that addresses this.
So if modalism was addressing the same hypostases, if it was addressing the same person, okay, what happened in Nicaea is that they said that you can't separate the persons. You can't separate the hypostases. So the Nicene Creed actually was going back to modalism, saying that you have to call them the same person, the same hypostases.
They were actually saying they were distinct persons. When you even read church fathers, there was no hesitation that they understood that the Father and Son were clearly distinct from one another.
Exactly. That is why the Nicene Creed is demonstration and evidence of apostasy, is because it goes back to and anathematizes.
That's a good point that you just brought up. I was thinking about this. This is a good, interesting question for me. According to LDS official teachings, just hear me out for a moment here. I want to at least give this out, because I was thinking about this, and this is actually an honest question in general with some of the things you brought up and some of the stuff that I was checking out with your video. According to LDS teachings, the great apostasy, the apostasy took place with the death, when the apostles died, correct? Just want a simple answer, yeah?
To simplify it actually began once the last bishop died that the apostles laid their hands on.
But the priesthood authority was lost, right?
Yes.
With the last death of the apostle, right?
Yes. So bishops were never given the authority to call other bishops and call their successors.
All right, so that's kind of what I'm trying to build on right now. So when the last apostle died, which would be John the apostle, John, who died of old age, the priesthood, according to LDS teachings, the Melchizedek priesthood and all those things that I don't agree with, I'm just trying to make a point, that, according to LDS teaching, ceased to exist, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. Now, according to LDS teachings, for one to be able to teach truth, to be a true servant of God, one would need the LDS Melchizedek priesthood, correct?
No, not necessarily. We find truth in all things.
Okay, but I'm told by LDS teachings that a person to be able to preach the gospel, to preach and teach, one must have the Melchizedek priesthood authority.
to become a missionary, they do. But again, we find truth in all things. It's not just, we find truth in everything that's true. That's what the 13th article of faith says.
That sounds like a Bible buffet. You can pick and choose what you want and you throw out the rest.
Articles of faith. Hang on. Article of faith. Oh, not that. Sad that I don't remember my own articles of faith, but we believe in being honest, true, chaste, benevolent, virtuous, and doing good to all men. Indeed, we say we follow the admonition of Paul. We believe all things, we hope all things, we have endured many things and hope to be able to endure all things. If there is anything virtuous, lovely, or of good report, or praiseworthy, we seek after these things. So we find truth in many things, and you don't need the priesthood to have truth. There's truth within Christianity. There's truth within Islam. There's truth within the New Age movement. It's picking out those good things, the virtuous things, that because there's a lot of lies in there as well. So we have to have a discernment to understand what's true. And if you're going there with the early church fathers and why they could teach the truth, they could teach the truth. They had truth. And we can pick out the truth from that.
So let me read a couple things to you. The reason why I'm asking is because I find it peculiar. I was thinking about this, why I'm actually want to ask this point, is because there's so much emphasis when I read, I don't need to give all these things. When I read LDS teachings from online books that I have, when the great apostate took place and the end of the apostles, the priesthood authority was gone, the true gospel was gone, God's representatives here were no longer, so therefore we were in the state of great apostasy. How do we know which to be true, right? And Joseph Smith said in his testimony, what's called Joseph Smith's history, I just want to read it again. It says over here, my object in 118 says, my object in going to inquire of the Lord was to know which of all the sects was right, that I might know which one to join. No sooner, therefore, did I get possession of myself as to be able to speak, than I asked the personages who stood above me in the light which of all the sects was right. For at that time, it never entered into my heart that they were all wrong and which I should join. I was answered that I must join none of them, for they were all wrong. And the personage who addressed me said all their creeds were an abomination in his sight, and that those professors were all corrupt, and they draw near me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. For they teach doctrines of the commandments of men, having a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. And the reason why I find this interesting, because that's what Joseph Smith was told. And then just give me one more quick second here. Back in the History of the Church, Volume 6, page 304, what's called the King Follett. Let me just read this and then get your thoughts on this, because this is what interests me. It says, but meddle not with any man for his religion. All governments ought to permit every man to enjoy his religion unmolested. I would agree with him there. No man is authorized to take away life in consequence of difference of religion. I would agree with him there. Which all laws and governments ought to tolerate, protect, right or wrong. Every man has a natural, in our country, constitutional right to be a false prophet, as well as the true prophet. If I show verily that I have the truth of God and show that 99 out of 100 professing religious ministers are false teachers, having no authority, while they pretend to hold the keys of God's kingdom on earth, now this part, not really a big deal, and was to kill them because they are false teachers, it would deluge the whole world with blood. That's a side note. I will prove that the world is wrong by showing what God is. I'm going to inquire after God. I want you all to know him and be familiar with him. And if I'm bringing to you a knowledge of him, all persecutions against me ought to cease. You will then know I am his servant, for I speak as one having authority. So correct me if I'm wrong, Robert. When I read Joseph Smith's testimony, when he was asking which to join, this and that, God says no, the creeds are an abomination, They teach commandments of men. They're corrupt professors, you know, professing all that. And then Joseph Smith here, this was, I wish I was alive at the time because I would have been loving to have a conversation with him. But he's like challenging all these people. He says, I'm going to prove you all wrong. I'm going to prove it to you by who, what being God is. And I'm going to show you all that I'm a true servant by what I teach. And basically, everyone else is false. So help me out with this, Robert. Isn't it fair to say that Joseph Smith, with his, if it's true, with his revelation that he believed he got from God, was basically challenging Christianity to prove him wrong?
Sure. I mean, it's always a challenge to, you know, prove or disprove truth. And there's many statements that to that effect. It says, you know, it says if we have the truth, I don't have it in front of me, but I mean, the fact is that, you know, again,
were you going to quote Brigham Young or Orson Pratt?
I was going to quote, I believe it was Cannon. He says that the truth, if we have the truth, it should go forth. If no one can harm the truth. And I don't quite remember.
Well, here's two quotes that you might like.
I'd love to look it up.
Brigham Young said in Journal of Discourses, volume 16, page 46, that I would say to the whole world, receive the truth. No matter who presents it to you, take up the Bible, compare the religion of the Latter-day Saints with it, and see if it will stand the test. That's one. Orson Pratt said in what's called The Seer, if we cannot convince you by reason nor by the word of God that your religion is wrong, we will cease. We will not persecute you. We will ask you the same generosity. Convince us of our error of doctrine. And if we have any by reason, by logical arguments, or by the word of God, we will be ever grateful for the information. I guess the reason why I was asking that is because a lot of times, this is why I was asking you these questions. Christians, basically, like myself, who are counter-cult apologists, we're actually responding to those who are saying we are the ones that actually been led astray or deceived. And a lot of times I'm told, oh, I hate Mormons, you're this or that. But I'm actually responding to what Joseph Smith said and other people said. So I just want to get your opinion. When you come across people like myself, do you think it's, you know, fair of us to actually give a response to what Joseph Smith challenged people with?
Well, again, you have to look at the Athanasian Creed. I mean, we can go back 1,500 years, and the Athanasian Creed says that anybody who doesn't believe in the Trinity is damned. So, you know, Christians fired the first shot by saying, well, you have to believe in the Trinity or you're damned. We don't believe in the Trinity.
Okay.
Therefore, all Trinitarians say we are damned automatically, and we are defending ourselves. And
interesting, though, you have to at least humor me for a second, though, Robert. For 1,800 something years, according to LDS teaching, there was no church on the earth. There was no prophet. And out of the blue, this guy rises up claiming he's a restored prophet, and he's teaching different information that's actually contrary to what the scriptures taught about God always being from everlasting to everlasting, the unchangeable God. He says, I will actually take away the veil and refute that idea and prove it to you. So in a way, though, I mean, he's kind of putting himself on the scene saying, look, hey, I'm the dude. Prove me wrong.
Right. And that's what we are, is we have the truth. And if, you know, the quote that I was looking for was by Reuben Clark. And it says, if we have the truth, it cannot be harmed by investigation. If we have not the truth, it ought to be harmed. So we believe that we have the truth and that it can't be harmed. So you look at the early Christian church, and I identified one area where there was an absolute evidence of apostasy, and that's the Nicene Creed. However, if you also look at bishops never obtained the right to be called to call other bishops, to call their successors. That just didn't happen. Apostles called bishops. Apostles called 70. This is in the Bible. Paul was an apostle. Barnabas was a 70. Titus was a 70.
Where do you get that? What reference would you get that from?
Church history. Okay. I mean, it calls Barnabas an apostle, calls Paul an apostle. Matthias.
Paul I know about, but I don't know about these other ones you're talking about.
Yeah, they're called apostles, but they're actually titled 70. and apostles is a quorum. They called the seven, they called other 70, and they called bishops. 70 called other bishops. They didn't call, so the 70 didn't call successors. So you have the, once the apostles started dying and the 70 started dying, you didn't have the transfer of authority for bishops to call and ordain other bishops. That just didn't happen. That is additional evidence of the apostasy.
Question for you on that, because this is going down a different direction, but I'm welcome to humor it. So the apostles had the priesthood, and then you are saying though the Bible doesn't teach this thing about the 70 anywhere at all about these people you're talking about. That's additional information. But nonetheless, you're saying this 70, this quorum. Well, when was the last people of the quorum to die who had the priesthood authority? Would they have outlived the apostles, or are you saying the 12 outlived all the other 70? What happened to those guys?
The apostles. So, but the 70 didn't have the authority to call other 70 either. The bishops didn't have authority to call other bishops. So once the last bishop died that had the authority, or had their hands laid on themselves with the proper authority, once they died, the apostasy officially became into existence. That is the official time and date that the apostasy occurred.
Let me ask a question, though. So how does somebody give somebody the priesthood authority? Who can have it?
They were laid on, we can look at when Judas died, and how the apostles, this is in Acts 1. Let me just go back real quick. So the apostle in Acts 14:14, it says, "But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd." This is saying that Barnabas was an apostle. But if you look at history and the historical record, Barnabas was an apostle, but he was a 70 apostle. And so there's kind of this difference, and it's kind of not real clear in the Bible, but it is through the history. So if you look at Acts.
But again, look, I want to focus on this, because this is actually an interesting point if you think about it for a second, Robert. So from your perspective, the priesthood authority died with the last of the apostles, which would be John, if I'm understanding that correctly. But prior to John and the apostles, the priesthood authority was given to many people. In fact, you would say the 70 that you're talking about, even though that's not in the Bible, but according to your view. And would it not be safe to say that other people that the apostles laid hands on, or the 70 that you say laid hands on, that there would have been other people who would have had the priesthood authority? Is that not correct?
Now, there's a difference between having the priesthood authority and having the keys to use it. Jesus gave, and this is actually evidence, when Jesus gave Peter the keys, there's the verse in Matthew 18, I'm sorry, Matthew 16, 18, that says that, I want to get the exact wording here, Matthew 16, 18. He says, "And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Now, I want to talk about these keys, because this isn't talking about that God promised Peter that the church would continue. It says that the gates of Hades will not prevail against the church. When gates prevail, they hold shut. Gates holding don't allow anything to go in or out. So the gates of hell, the gates of Hades, gates of the land of the dead, didn't hold. They didn't hold shut. They didn't prevail. They opened. That's not prevailing. So the gates of Hades did not prevail against the church. Jesus gave Peter the keys to those gates. He says that whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So those keys were not given to.
So was Peter the only one with these keys?
No. In Matthew 18, 18, the rest of the apostles got the same keys.
What about the quorum? Did they have it?
Matt, that only the 12 held those specific keys. But this is where we get Peter at the gates of heaven, at the pearly gates. This is where that comes from. So in Matthew 18:18, the rest of the apostles got these same keys. Those keys weren't given to everybody. You don't have the ability to go around and bind on earth what is bound in heaven. That is given to a very few people. Those are the keys that were lost when the apostles died. They were able to call their successor. They called, after Judas died, they called Matthias. And Matthias became one of the 12. But they called him as a quorum, as a whole.
Again, additional information from the Bible, but go ahead.
No, that's what it says in Acts.
There's no quorum in the New Testament with these people, but go ahead.
Acts 1:1. They cast, or I'm sorry, the Acts 1, not 1:1. They cast lots as a quorum. They all.
There's no quorum of 70 in the New Testament after the death of Jesus. There's nothing that recorded at all.
Matthias was an apostle. He was called as an apostle after Judas died.
That's different. He replaced Judas. You even acknowledge Barnabas was called an apostle. You acknowledge Paul. These are additional to the 12. So there would be others who would have this priesthood authority, not just the original 12 or those guys. So that goes outside of what you just said.
It didn't fall down into the bishops, though. The bishops didn't have the authority to bind on earth what was bound in heaven.
So I'm going to go back to my question, though. I'm respecting what you're saying, but my question back was this Melchizedek priesthood authority, the basic nuts and bolts of this here, there would have been other people other than the apostles and other than these other Christian leaders that you're talking about that would have had the priesthood authority. So why is it that God could have, why is it that God still couldn't have been working through these people, raising up pastors, raising up teachers, raising up apostles, whatever you want to say? Why did it end with John the Apostle if other people would have had the LDS priesthood authority?
Because they didn't have the keys to use that authority. They did not have the keys to bind in heaven what is bound on earth. Only the apostles had that authority.
And that's so official LDS teaching? That's what they teach?
This is official LDS teaching, yeah.
So yeah, I've never read that directly before like that, so that's something I want to look up.
Okay. I don't have an actual quote where you can. It's just this is what we teach because the apostles have that authority today to bind on heaven what is bound on earth. And we call that the sealing power, which is what is used when we get married in the temple, that we are married for eternity. So mm-hmm. What you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Our marriages are bound on earth, and they're also bound in heaven, the sealing power.
So going back to what I was trying to get to about church fathers and early church and all that, why would somebody go through so much work to use what's considered apostate by the Lord, apparently, to prove points for Mormonism, particularly Joseph Smith? And the reason why I ask that is because what I find interesting, as I shared earlier, I gave references from the Book of Mormon. I gave references from Doctrine of the Covenant that clearly state against what Joseph Smith stated, that God, we've imagined God was always God, but I'm going to take away the veil and refute that idea. But yet there are scriptures in the Bible, and there are things in the Book of Mormon and Doctrine and Covenants that actually refutes Joseph Smith's teachings on that. So why would you want to go to church fathers when you already have what you would call the standard works, your inspired writings, that actually would refute that?
First of all, it doesn't refute
that. That's just a personal question.
Again, it doesn't really refute what you're saying, but I go to the church fathers because they had the truth, a lot of the truth. They didn't have all of the truth. There was, you can actually track the apostasy. I can go through and I can view infant baptism. Infant baptism wasn't taught at the beginning. 200 AD, he fought against infant baptism. And apostasy is basically when you believe something like that adults needed to be baptized, and then you discuss it and you debate it and you fight against it, and then eventually you accept it, and canonize it, that to me is apostasy. And I saw that with infant baptism. It was actually canonized and codified by the year 250 by the Council of African Bishops. So you can track infant baptism and how it fell away. You can track the Trinity and how at first they believed in separate hypostases, separate ousias, and they believed that they were separate beings, separate gods, another god, two gods. They named this. I mean, you could go and you can read this in the early church texts.
No church fathers taught that the Father and Jesus were two different gods.
Yes, they taught that Jesus and the Father were two separate gods.
Which, give a reference for it. Who referenced that?
Okay. It looked for the Dialogue of Heraclides.
What year was that?
Hang on. I'm going to pull it up here. Dialogue with Heraclides. It is, it's actually with Origen, but give me a second because it's not Origen.
All right, so let's talk about before the creeds. Which apostolic or church fathers before any creeds were done taught that the Father and the Son were two separate gods?
And Heraclides actually says, Origen says, is the Son distinct from the Father? Heraclides responds, of course. How can he be the Son if he's also the Father? Origen says, while being distinct from the Father, is the Son himself also God? Heraclides responds and says, he himself is also God. Origen replies and says, do two gods become a unity? Yes. Origen says, do we confess two gods? Bishop Heraclides, he's a bishop, says, yes, the power is one. Not only that, but then Origen goes into this dialogue to explain how they are two gods and how they are one God.
And when was that written?
I don't have a date, but it's around 250 AD.
Okay.
Probably about 220 AD, because there's five named bishops here. Okay. There's Bishop Maximus.
And you did something finally good. You actually gave a reference that was actually finally backing up what you said. But I don't like Origen has a lot of bad teaching in general.
I understand. That's why I'm saying this was not Origen. This is five named bishops. Five named bishops: Maximus, Demetrius, Dionysus, and Bishop Heraclides. There's four. The other one is, these are named bishops.
So when
Bishop Philip,
Doctrines and Covenants 20:28 says the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit are one God. When you've got 2 Nephi 31:21 says the Father and the Spirit and the Son are one God. When you've got the Bible unequivocally stating over and over there is one God, are you going to use those guys above what you call standard works or scripture?
No, because we view them the same way that you do. If you can, you're reading.
You don't believe the Church Fathers are inspired.
You're reading the Book of Mormon with Trinitarian eyeglasses on, and
it actually teaches the Trinity more than you realize.
You're reading it with Trinitarian eyeglasses on, and if you take those off, you realize that God is a unity.
Go to Doctrines and Covenants 20, and you help me out. You put the proper glasses on for me. Let's go to Doctrines and Covenants 20, and you help me out. You correct me where I'm wrong here, okay? Let me give you the couple references that I shared already. Verse 17 says, these things we know, there is a God in heaven who is infinite and eternal from everlasting to everlasting, the same unchangeable God, the framer of the heaven, the earth, and all things that are therein. That refutes the King Follett discourse. 28 says, which the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost are one God, infinite and eternal, without end. So you correct me where my glasses are teaching something wrong.
Okay, they are a unity. He's describing them as a collective. Collectives are one flesh, one church. There are many churches within one church, one group of believers. All believers are one. They're one group. There is one God. These three are a collective God. And that's the way the Book of Mormon teaches it, that they are a collective group.
Well, it's interesting because I'm going back over here. This is fascinating stuff to me because I just again want to read what Joseph Smith said. Just give me one second here. So Joseph Smith said here, again, page 305 of the King History of the Church, volume 6. He says this: in order to understand the subject of the dead, for the consolation of those who mourn for the loss of their friends, It's necessary that we should understand the character and being of God and how he came to be so. For I'm going to tell you how God came to be God. We have imagined and supposed that God was God from all eternity. I will refute that idea and take away the veil so that you may see. These are incomprehensible ideas to some, but they are simple. It is the first principle of the gospel. It is the first principle of the gospel to know for certainly the character of God, and to know that we may converse with one as a man converses with another, that he was once a man like us, the God himself, the Father of us all, dwelt on the earth, same as Jesus Christ did. And I'll show it to you in the Bible. So I want to again point this out. He says we've imagined and supposed that God was God from eternity. But over here, Doctrine and Covenants 2017 says, these things we know there is a God in heaven who is infinite, eternal, from everlasting to everlasting, the same unchangeable God, the framer of heaven and earth, and all things which are in them. Correct my misunderstanding here.
Again, you believe that Jesus came down that as God and added humanity to himself. That was a change. God changed. He became human. So the question isn't does God change? It's how does God change? And the way that he's describing God's unchangeableness is the same way that he's always righteous. He can't lie. He's perfect in every way. He's not saying that he can't come down and take a body on. That's not what he's not saying that, because you believe that God came down to take a body. All right.
But, we just believe, Robert, that the Father did. This is what it says here. I'm quoting him. It says, we have imagined and supposed that God was God from all eternity. Right. I refute that idea and take it away. It goes on to say, he was a man like us, God himself, the Father of us all. According to you, he was first a man who became a God.
No, Doctrine, I didn't say that.
17 states that he was eternal from everlasting to everlasting God.
Just like Jesus was God beforehand, we believe that Heavenly Father was God before he came to his earth and before he got a body. So there's nothing. They were the Elohim. The Elohim are the gods. Again, intelligences are not created. Intelligence exists. And you are an intelligence. God was an intelligence. He's just more intelligent than you are. He's more intelligent than all of us are. So, but
doesn't it seem like, just, you know, let's just speak simple.
Okay.
Simple. Joseph Smith says we've imagined that God's always been God, eternal, everlasting. But over here in 2017, let me just read a couple of verses after, or things after it. By these things we know there's a God in heaven who is infinite, eternal. This goes opposition to what Joseph Smith said. From everlasting to everlasting, the same unchangeable God, the framer of heaven and earth and all things which are in. And he created man, male and female, after his own likeness. Sorry, in his own image. And after his own likeness created he them. In 19, he gave unto them commandments that they should love and serve him, the only living and true God, and that we should be only being, and that he should be the only being whom they should worship. How do you respond to that?
Okay, Kelly, I can explain it to you. I can't understand it for you. My answer is the same. He is the same from eternity to eternity. It's just how he changes. You believe Jesus changed. You believe God changed. He became man. That is a change.
But this is talking about the Father here, right?
So, we're talking about the Father. Well, so, okay. So let's look at it this way.
Joseph Smith is saying God the Father was not always God the Father, correct?
Correct. Yes, okay. He did not have that title. That is a title.
Okay. So 2017 says that God in heaven is infinite, eternal, everlasting, everlasting. Is that true? Yes or no?
That is true. He is so everlasting,
how can God everlasting. Be eternally God, but first he was a man who became a God. Something doesn't make sense to me.
Never said he was eternally God. He was an eternally. He was eternally an intelligence.
Unchangeable God.
He was eternally an intelligence.
Doesn't say that.
That's when you understand DNC 93, verse 29, that says intelligence can neither be created nor, I quoted that. Intelligences cannot be created. All right. So since they cannot be created, he existed eternally. The only difference is we believe that that intelligence took on a spirit and then took on a body. The same thing, the same way that you did. You took your intelligence, your I am, that exists within you somewhere in your head.
Hey, that's a really, boy, that's so new age. Where do you get this intelligence I am thing? Where did that come from?
Who
teaches that?
DNC 93, verse 29.
And it actually says you have the I am in your head?
No, I'm just saying the I am is what exists. It's what truly exists. When Jesus says I am, he was using the word Einai, which means he exists, that he is, that there's ontological something there. He is the I am, the premier I am.
Can you say what that was again? What is it? How did you say it was? I am is what?
The Einai,
where's that from?
The Hebrew?
No, that's Aye Asher. Aye is the Hebrew for that. I am. Aye.
Okay. Okay.
All right. The Greek is ego a me. I was just trying to figure out where you were going with that.
Okay. I said it wrong, but you got my point. So that exists. That's always existed. The I am that you are has always existed. And that's what is taught in DNC 93, verse 29.
That is some crazy stuff, my friend. All right. Well, listen, there are so many more things I would love to address, but we're over the hour and 7 minute mark. And I think we have shared some interesting points. I don't think we were both really able to really communicate probably what we were trying, but I think it went well in regards to having a friendly debate / conversation. Would you agree?
Yeah, this is fine. I'm enjoying myself.
All right.
So now, we're ready for some questions.
I know that you would believe that you did a really good job, and I don't think you did a good job, but I appreciate you coming up to share your perspective. And you shared some new things that I wasn't expecting. I was expecting something else, to be honest with you. So you always got a bag of tricks, Robert. I was surprised. So
I'm glad to keep things interesting.
I'll have to check out that other one you were talking about before. All right. Well, let's take a little break here. So everyone out there listening, you guys have been, for the most part, from what I have watched every now and then, thank you for being respectful in the text chat area. All right. So what we would like to do here is take a little break, and what we're going to allow you guys to do who are here, there's a few of you, if you have a question that you would like to ask Robert or myself, just put the @ so that we know who it's to, or you can say both of us. And just put a question up there, and we'll try to keep it in order the best that we can. If I miss a question, just repost it, okay? And be respectful with whatever you ask. And then when me and Robert are responding, we'll try to keep, I mean, this is hard, but try to keep it a minute or so short. That way we can go through many questions that we get our direction, all right? All right, so who has a question out there? All right, so the first question here, all right, so Jeff Koons got the first one up here. So Jeff Koons asked, Robert, what is the Catholic guy's name that said a divine being?
The Catholic guy's name that said a divine being, that was... I go through my references here. Reverend John L. McKenzie, McKenzie.
All right. Good stuff. All right. Let's go on to the next one here. All right. This could be for both of us here. That one, because that one definitely was not. Robert, what is The gospel. Good luck with that with 60 seconds, right?
What is the gospel? It's the mess. It's the good news. It's the message that Jesus Christ gave us that we can return back to our Heavenly Father. So that's basically what the gospel is.
That's all you got?
Okay. I could go on, but that's
okay. All right. Well, we're both going to be able to give a response in regards just to being fair, unless it's something that's only for one of us directly, of course, and that would be different. The gospel. Now, you know what? Let's just keep it simple. If it's directed to you, I don't want to go a different direction. We'll keep it simple like that. Okay. All right. Because that could be weird. All right. Let's see here. Let's go with Steve. Let's see here. Steven. Hey, Steven. Steven asks, all right, you're the popular guy. Robert, do you think humans and angels and gods to be the same specific species of beings?
So the word angel simply means messenger. That's all it means. It doesn't talk about different beings. It says that, yes. So it says that in Psalm somewhere, says that man was created a little lower than the Elohim, which means a little lower than the gods. And they didn't like that, so they changed it, and they actually translated it and said, man has been created a little lower than the angels. So angel simply means messenger. They are the Elohim, and an angel is just a title. It is not a separate species. It's not a separate nature, divine nature. It is simply a rank that they hold as a messenger of God.
All right. I'm actually going to correct myself. I think it probably should be fair if I get a question and you could respond to it. So I'll give a quick response just here and there as well. All right. So, Robert, do you think humans and angels are gods? I was actually thinking about this too. I didn't ask it today, but it's an interesting thought because the Bible says Michael is, you know, the archangel. He's a created angel. Satan is called, he's created an angel, according to the Bible. And I was always curious because it's interesting when we look at mankind, mankind was created in the image of God. God, not, I don't believe, Heavenly Mother. But angels were distinct. And it's curious is, you know, do angels, you know, do they become gods even though they're created angels? I was just thinking that was kind of an interesting thought. So I kind of wonder if that's where Steve might be going. So that's kind of where I was just making a quick comment there. Jeff here asks back to you, Robert, what was the source? And that, I guess it's back to the question on the Catholic thing. What's the source?
Is he asking about the source of the Catholic thing or?
Yeah, the Catholic guy on that divine, you were talking about the divine.
That was in his Catholic, that was in his Dictionary of the Bible. And the source, just John 1:1, the source of angels becoming, or man being made a little lower than the angels, is Psalm 8:5. It says, man was made a little lower than the Elohim.
Well, I think he was just asking for the source just in regards to that Catholic guy for the book for where you were getting. Okay. I think that's what it was. All right, this will be a fun one. James asks, Robert, if I was going to die in 60 seconds, how do I get saved?
if your last 60 seconds, it doesn't work like that. Is she asking me the last 60 seconds of life?
Yeah, if you had 60 seconds, you're going to die in 60 seconds, he's asking.
We do not believe in deathbed repentance. You will be judged by what you have done and how good you were as a, by what knowledge you had. In other words, even atheists, if you are a good atheist and you don't believe in God, but you are a good person, we believe that those people will have a second chance to accept God. I don't want to say first, I'm sorry. There are no second chances. They do not get a second chance. They will get a first chance to understand the gospel and accept God in the next life. If you are a Christian and you are a very bad Christian, you will not be going to heaven. So you are not saved as a bad Christian. Those are those who Jesus says I never knew you, you workers of iniquity.
Yeah, James, and I think I know James. So the gospel of being saved in 60 seconds is simple. The Bible teaches for the wages of sin is death. Romans 6:23. For all have sinned and fall short to the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Sin is what separates us from God. Isaiah 59:1-2. The Bible teaches that when we die, Hebrews 9:27, we die and then it's to judgment. So Jesus Christ, who is the Savior, the Son that was sent, God come in the flesh. He was the one that came to give his life for us. He died upon the cross to fulfill Old Testament prophecies, Isaiah 53, and through his atonement, anyone who puts their complete trust, as Paul says in Romans 10:9-13, says, if you believe in your heart that Jesus has been raised from the dead, you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and you call upon him, you shall be saved. There is a big difference when it comes to salvation. If you want to learn more about salvation, according to Robert, watch our first debate. Enough said on that one. All right. Looks like we got another one here for Robert. Robert's a popular guy. All right. Robert from Walter says here, concerning the Shema, it says, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. The Hebrew is Echad. Echad is a compound unity. So Elohim is God. God is more than one person. Address that.
Right. Elohim is a plural of gods. It means gods. There is a singular form, which is Eloha. Eloha is where the Muslims get Allah from. Allah, Eloha, those are the same forms. The Muslims believe in one singular God. That is the Eloha in Hebrew. So Elohim is a compound plurality. It is a group of gods. And you can't number these. You can't just limit them to three. But we do know that the Lord, Yahweh, is the one God who we need to worship out of all the others.
Walter's a good question. In regards to that, I was talking about this a little bit earlier. A couple chapters before that, in chapter 4, Moses writes in verse 35, unto thee it was showed that there might knowest that the Lord, he is God, and there is none else beside him. Out of heaven he made thee to hear his voice, and he might instruct thee. And upon the earth he showed thee his great fire. And thou heardest words out of the midst of the fire. And because he loved thy fathers, therefore he chose their seed after them. And he brought thee out of the sight with the mighty power out of Egypt, to drive out the nations before thee, greater and mightier than thou art, to bring thee in, to give thee their land of inheritance, as it is to this day. Verse 39, know thou therefore this day, and consider it in thine heart, that the Lord their God, he is God in heaven above, upon the earth, and there is none else. All right, looks like we got Nicole here. Robert, what do you think about Lorenzo Snow's statement? Okay, it's kind of what we talked about before. As man now is, God once was. As God now is, man may be. Joseph Smith said, it is true gospel. Does this mean God could sin? Well, that's an interesting question.
Let me just throw this using Christian terms. As Jesus was, man now is. As Jesus is, man will be. Do you believe Jesus ever sinned? Is Jesus God?
That's your answer?
That's my answer.
Okay. I also think it's interesting, it kind of goes back to our conversation, as man now is, God once was. This, again, like for the sake of, you know, not in any way intentionally being disrespectful, this just shows the very disconnect that you and myself have, because there are scriptures like here, again, Isaiah 44, I was going to talk about this before, I never got to it, but Isaiah 44, verse 6, fear ye not, neither be afraid. Have I not told you from the time or declared it that you are my witnesses? Is there a God beside me? Yea, no God, I know of not any. it's interesting because when we look at this teaching that Lorenzo Snow or what Joseph Smith taught, there is this implication that there are many gods and that we can become gods at some point too. But yet scripture unequivocally affirms time after time after time, this is not the case.
Can I address that real quick?
Briefly, but then I get a response.
Okay, that's fine. You brought up Isaiah. Again, Isaiah is using poetic language. He says the same thing about Babylon. He says, I am Babylon and none else beside me. That doesn't mean that he's not saying that there are no gods that will be exalted after him.
Which verse are you looking at?
The Babylon quote is Isaiah 47:8. Okay, it's in the same context. Isaiah 47:8 says, I am, and he's talking about Babylon, city of Babylon, and none else beside me. So you can't take the poetic language that Isaiah is using literally. And every single church father from the very beginning all believed that the end result was to become gods, to become deified. John says that when Jesus comes, that we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. So when we become like him, we will become like him. We will become gods, glorified and divine beings, partakers of the divine nature. 2 Peter 1:4.
Stop for a second. What are you saying Isaiah 47:8 is teaching?
Poetic language. It says, I am Babylon. He's talking about the city of Babylon and none else beside me. He's not talking about saying, he's not saying that there are no other cities than Babylon. He's using poetic language to describe Babylon's incomparability, Babylon's incomparability. So all his other language that he's talking about, none of the other divine Elohim can compare to him.
He's actually mocking Babylon. If you go exactly before it, and he says, sit thou silent and get thee into darkness, O daughter of Chaldeans, for thou shalt not be called the Lady of Kingdoms. I was wroth with my people. I polluted my inheritance and given them into thy hand. Thou didst show them no mercy. Upon the ancient hast thou heavily laid thy yoke. Thou sayest, I shall be a lady forever.
So right. We know that he's mocking him.
Reading context. So that those did not lay these things to thy heart, neither didst answer the latter end of it. Therefore, hear now this, thou art given to pleasure, to dwellest carelessly, that saith in thy heart, thou sayest in thy heart, I am none else beside me. I shall not sit as a widow, neither shall I know the loss of children. He's actually saying to the Babylon, you are saying, don't say it in your heart. You are beside yourself. He's actually rebuking him. He's not making that. That's a very different context to what I shared a minute ago from Isaiah 44:8, where it says here, is there a God beside me? I do not know of any. No.
I'm making a point that that's an idiom. It's a Hebrew idiom that declares incomparability. I'm not saying that Babylon wasn't sinning in saying that. I'm saying that that was an idiom. It was using poetic language to describe that there aren't any other cities that compare with Babylon.
I don't know how that goes with that, but okay, let's move on. What else we got here?
Jeff, are you not getting any questions?
Jeff, let's just move on. Jeff asked, what is the source for a divine being, not angels? What is the page? He has the book. He's asking you directly.
Divine being, he's got the page.
Don't mess with Jeff. He has it all. I know him.
let me get back with you. I'll look it up.
All right. Let's get another one here. Let's to our surprise again to you. Robert, in Matthew 3:17 and 17:5. Who said, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased? Well, I already know the answer to that one.
And John, okay, repeat the verse.
17 and 17:5.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
It's on the screen. Can you see it?
What is this? What is the source for a divine being, not angels?
Oh, no. Are you not in StreamYard still?
I'm going back and forth. So
in the StreamYard, you should be able to see it directly right away.
Matthew 3:17 and 17:5. This is my beloved son, who I am well pleased. That is Heavenly Father and speaking as Heavenly Father, talking about or witnessing and testifying of his son, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I don't know, understand what he was trying to ask there. I was kind of confused on that one. Oh, I actually got a good one. Someone asked me a question? Oh, wait. Holy moly. All right. All of a sudden, my screen just jumped. Sorry, one second here. Sometimes it does that once in a while. You're like, oh, look at all that stuff. All right, here we go. I'm going to get this one over here for me. All right, this one goes to me. Isaiah 43:10 at Kelly. Cite it.
Cite it.
I am God. There is none other. There is no God before me, neither shall there be after me. Yeah, I actually talked about that in my opening. Let me go to it. I think this is actually interesting. I'd like to hear your thoughts on this, Robert. Isaiah 43:10 states, "You are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, and that ye may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, and neither shall there be after me." All right, a couple of quick points to you, Walter. It's a good point. I am goes back to the self-existent one when God revealed himself to Moses as the eternal I am. And it's interesting here. It says, "You are my witnesses," declares or saith the Lord. So this is Yahweh speaking here. And he goes on to say that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, and neither shall there be after me. So Walter's an interesting verse, because that word I shared earlier for the word formed is the Hebrew word yatsar, Y-A-T-S-A-R, which has the meaning to be made, brought into existence, fashioned, or formed. What this would imply to me, Walter, which actually, again, would refute Joseph Smith, his teachings, is that God, there was no God before him, formed, brought into existence, came into being, and there'll be none after him. And what makes this even that much more interesting is when you read Isaiah 43:10 and the preceding chapters and the after chapters, the consistency shows that God has always been God. There wasn't a point when he wasn't. And this would go against what Joseph Smith taught, that before God was God, he was once a man who became a God, just like all the gods that did before him, and we too shall be. So that Isaiah 43:10 is a great reference, Walter. What would you like to say to that on the word yatsar there, Robert?
Isaiah is using poetic language all throughout. You cannot take what he says literally. Otherwise, we're living on a flat earth.
Oh, all right. Okay, let's move on. This one's at Kelly here. It looks like Nicole forgot to say Kelly. I see it after here. All right. Nicole writes, "Jesus is God in the flesh, but we do not say Jesus wasn't. We do not say Jesus wasn't spirit God. You are saying God was flesh first as man, not like as man, like us, not man, like Jesus." Nicole, God bless you. I have no idea what that means. I'm going to read it one more time. "Jesus is God in the flesh, but we do not say Jesus wasn't spirit God." You are saying God was flesh first as man, like us, not man, like Jesus. I'm going to see if Nicole typed after that to see if she clarified that, because that's kind of, she did not. Okay. I'm not sure what that means, what you're actually directly asking there, Nicole. I'm sorry. I don't want to answer it wrongly, but unless you think you understand it. Do you understand it? It almost seems like she's talking to you.
But I think so. I think she's talking to me, but I'm not understanding it either.
All right. Maybe she'll say it one more.
God was not flesh first. He was God in as a spirit. He was an Elohim as a spirit. He became man. And he was, well, okay. I think one thing is, Jesus, the Bible says that Jesus received his power and his glory. In Daniel, it talks about the fact that Jesus was presented before the Ancient of Days, and the Ancient of Days gave him power and dominion, okay? So what was he before he received that power and dominion? John says the same thing. He says that there's God sitting on the throne, the Father sitting on the throne, and Jesus is in the crowd, and he comes up and he takes the book, and later he gets power and dominion. In verse 11, in Revelation 5:11, it talks about how he received. But what was Jesus before God gave him power and dominion?
You're done? Okay. This is interesting because, you know, I've already said this before. Philippians 2:6, it says that Jesus was in the form of God, who the Greek word is morphe. He is by nature God, existing before he came to this earth and took on flesh. And something that I haven't addressed and what you've also shared too, quick point on that goes with this question, is that you've repeatedly said Jesus changed. Jesus was still always God come in the flesh. That's Philippians chapter 2, Hebrews chapter 1, John chapter 1. Jesus was always God come in the flesh. He just took on our likeness to give his life as a sacrifice. But he never changed his nature in regards to him being God. So that doesn't refute anything that I've already shared before on this. I think what's interesting with Nicole here, because this again goes back to the big difference of Christianity and Mormonism. Because if I understand her correctly, or you're saying God was first flesh, a man, and then he progressed to become God. And that's actually what Joseph Smith taught. You said repeatedly, Robert, that we are these intelligences or something of that effect, which I'm just going to speak openly, is just mind-blowing. And just I can't even believe I hear that, because there's nothing in the Bible that gives any kind of indication like that, nor even the references that I've already shared from LDS sources, that God has eternally been God. So Joseph Smith says, we've imagined God's always been God, but I'm going to refute that idea. But yet the Bible says it, even LDS sources say it, but yet somehow that's not true. All right.
Well, again, I have to go back to Daniel's vision and John's revelation and ask you, what was Jesus before he was given power and dominion by Heavenly Father? So right, we'll have to research
time here. I'm going to let you finish off with that one, because you spoke and I spoke and then you spoke again, but I won't give a response. I won't worry about it. All right. Listen, we've had lots of questions or some we didn't get to. God bless all of you guys out there. Thank you for and Jeff actually responds to you, says he's got the book. He's going to check it out, obviously. All right. Well, this has been good. I think we both have covered a lot of grounds. We'll wrap up with our 5 minutes each. And then afterwards, when it's all said and done, we can briefly chat with each other on StreamYard. So don't leave after, when it's all said and done. I'll talk, you talk, and then I'll give a quick close as I wrap up in regards just to the channel stuff. I won't give like any additional stuff, okay?
Okay.
All right, here we go. All right, that there. Let's just restop this and start it again. All right, that there. All right, here we go. All right. Well, folks, God bless you all. You know, this has been a great discussion. There's definitely lots of things I'm even sure Robert would agree that we could even share more. What I want to end with is this. Joseph Smith is the one who came on the scene and challenged Christianity. He said, and I quote again, "The first principle of the gospel is to know for certainty the character of God." This is interesting to me. The first principle of the gospel, according to Joseph Smith, was to prove God has not always been God from eternity. But folks, you've listened. If you've been here the whole time, you've seen it in Scripture. Isaiah 40, verse 28, the eternal God. Psalm 90, verse 2. Psalm 93, verse 2. From everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. God throughout Genesis to Revelation is clearly defined as being eternal. There was never a time when he was not. In fact, there are many scriptures that says that there is no God beside him. Yet Joseph Smith would say that there was gods before the Father and there'll be gods after. Isn't it perplexing to say, well, if God says, I know of not any other God, why wouldn't he say he knew about his father who was God or the other father was God or a plethora of gods? It doesn't fit the bill. The Bible is consistent. There is one God who is eternal. And there are three who's, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Everything that I've shared tonight is biblically accurate within its proper context. You don't need to have any special imaginary glasses to reinterpret things as been portrayed on the other side, respectfully saying. The clear context, when you read these things, they are clear. Night is clear as day, right? And when you read even LDS sources, this is what is mind-boggling to me. Even in LDS sources, they affirm what we say. When we say we believe that the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit are one God, we call that the triunity of God. There are things in the scripture. He will try to say, oh, well, there are unity, whatever. That's great. But yet the Bible says, before me there was no God formed, and neither shall there be after me. That word formed is, again, the Hebrew word yatsar. It means there was no gods brought into existence before him or after him. God says, I know of not any other. This is the clear thing. I end with this, and this is probably one of the most important things I'll probably say in this discussion. Joseph Smith, whether intentional or unintentional, has deceived millions upon millions of Mormons over the years. You see, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing. Inwardly, they are ravenous wolves. We read that from within the church, from within the Christian ranks, false teachers would rise up and mislead people. Paul talks about that in Acts chapter 20, verses 28 through 21. One of the most important things I want to end is this. 2 Corinthians 11:4 states that there is another Jesus, another gospel, and another spirit. We need to test ourselves, test the scriptures, examine the scriptures. Don't be led astray by our emotions or hearsay. What is the clear consistency of the scriptures? This is what we believe as Christians. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Galatian church, said this, and I quote, verse 6, I marvel that you're so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another. But though there be some that trouble you or would pervert the gospel of Christ, but though we or an angel from heaven preached any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so I now say again, if any man preach another gospel, any other gospel unto you that which you have not received, let him be accursed. Joseph Smith said, we have imagined and supposed that God was God from all eternity. I will refute that and take away the veil that you may see. These are incomprehensible ideas of some, but they are simple. It is the first principle of the gospel to know for certainty the character of God, so that we may converse with him as one man converses with another, that he was once a man like us, and God himself the Father of us all. The gospel of Mormonism, the gospel of Joseph Smith, is another gospel. And I pray that any of you out there who are serious would take the time to examine these scriptures for yourself. Be a Berean. Test all things. Hold fast to that which is good and true. Lord bless. All right. Robert, you're up.
Okay. In the beginning, God, the Father alone was God. And Jesus was a divine being who worshiped the Father as God, as his God, even in heaven. As Daniel records, Jesus was the Son of Man who came to the Ancient of Days sitting on his throne and was exalted with power, dominion, and kingdoms. As John records, he was the Lamb that came and took the book from the God sitting on the throne, and he did the work that God asked him to do. He was exalted, saying, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing." If you have to receive those things, that means that is something you did not have originally. So Christians and Trinitarians who try to get around these scriptures, you're going against the Bible. You don't believe the Bible if you're rejecting these things. Since Jesus does the work of the Father, we don't worship them separately, but maintain their oneness through a collective unity. They are one. However, there is nothing that provides more observable evidence of apostasy than the Trinity. When you have a non-Christian emperor dictating the philosophical doctrine of the Greeks to the Christian church and enforcing that doctrine by the sword, you are sure to have apostasy. There were only two bishops who stood up against the emperor and his Nicene Creed. There were several more that originally signed it, but later recanted, saying, "We acted impiously, Your Majesty, in subscribing to the heresy from fear of you." They were all stripped of their stoles and exiled. The amount of peer pressure that they faced trying to sign this thing and trying to understand it was just beyond comprehension. The language that came out of Nicaea was so confusing and controversial that it took the next several hundred years to actually formulate the Trinitarian doctrine that you believe today. I don't actually have a problem with believing in a Trinity of three separate beings and gods who are over all. I call that the Godhead. That's the way that it was taught before Nicaea. But when you redefine the Trinity as three separate persons against what the dictionary says, and they're not beings, that's like trying to redefine the barbershop quartet as four singers, but as four cows. If I were to go around preaching the barbershop quartet as four cows in one singing quartet, I'd be laughed at. Yet the Trinity at its core does basically the same thing by redefining God as persons. Redefining terms is at the heart of apostasy. We see examples of that today with same-sex marriage. Same-sex relations were first condemned, then they were argued, then accepted. It redefined what it means to be a father, a mother, and family. Throughout history, the same thing occurred with infant baptism. At first, it wasn't accepted, then it was argued, then it was accepted and codified. So the Trinity redefined different divine beings in the same way. At first, Jesus and the Father were separate divine beings. Then it was argued and debated, and ultimately that was condemned. Today, you call them three persons or hypostases, but doing so runs against the original anathemas of the creed. Counting them into three is, by definition, separating them. This makes everyone today a heretic to the very Nicene Creed that they quote each week. This is the clearest and most empirical evidence that a universal apostasy occurred. If you have an apostasy, there's also a need for a restoration. Joseph Smith was the prophet of that restoration. He was called of God and saw God the same as the prophets of old did and delivered God's message to the world. And I bear that with my personal witness. Amen.
All right. Well, that concludes our discussion debate. We're going to wrap it up. Won't address any more comments in the text out there. Thank you though for sharing, guys, out there. If you want to leave a comment on the video that after this is published and all that, leave a comment on the video and we can obviously address it. I'm sure Robert can check it out from time to time and just leave a comment for Robert over there. You guys can have a conversation with him over there as well. I also have a link in my YouTube description for his channel. If you want to go check out, he doesn't have a lot, but you can go check out his channel. So any concluding thoughts, Robert, before we wrap up, any thoughts just for me and you? Are you happy with our conversation?
Yeah. I thought it went well.
Okay. I think it was very respectful. In fact, I think it was actually less heated than our first one, I think a little bit anyway.
Okay.
No, but I don't know.
I don't like the heated conversations. I like the respectful ones. I haven't ever felt threatened. I guess I can handle the heat better than others and reflect it or redirect it.
Yeah. Well, I think, for the most part, even though, we obviously have some very different conclusions of what we both have shared, but I will say this, I've enjoyed talking with you now, this being the second time. And I'm sure we'll have you on again at another point. And I thank you for your willingness to come on here.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks for having me.
All right. We'll wrap up and we'll chat in just a minute there. All right. All right, everybody out there. Well, thank you for joining. Again, check out Robert's channel if you want to check it out over there. But feel welcome to leave comments on this channel in regards to the video. And we'll see what happens. So thank you for all being here. Lord bless you. We'll see you at another time. We'll wrap up. Thank you for all being here.
Last night put the heavy on me. Woke up and I'm feeling lonely. This world got a way of showing me. Some days it'll lift you up. Some days it'll call you bluff. Man, most of my days I ain't got enough. And all I know is you're my only hope. Defector. 'Cause all I know, all I know.